The video, which has been viewed over 23 million times, resulted in the cancellation of the twerking classes at the school and an investigation by Russian authorities as to whether a debauched action took place. FPP Radio News is brought to you by Coinbase. Coinbase is a simple and secure online Bitcoin wallet for sending, receiving, and storing Bitcoin. Coinbase also allows you to buy and sell Bitcoin using a bank account or use their tools to accept Bitcoin as a merchant. Coinbase has more than 1 million consumer wallets and is trusted by over 25,000 merchants, including Overstock.com, Khan Academy, Reddit, and of course, FPP. Get started at coinbase.fppradio.com. Reuters reports the U.S. Supreme Court is set to hear arguments this week on whether a drug used in Oklahoma's lethal injection mix should be banned in a case that comes as the shortage of execution chemicals has sent some states scrambling for alternatives. The main question before the nine justices in the case brought by three death row inmates that will be heard on Wednesday is whether the use of the sedative midazolam violates constitutional protections against cruel and unusual punishment. The case does not address the constitutionality of the death penalty in general, but brings fresh attention to the debate over whether executions should continue in the United States. Executions in Oklahoma came under great scrutiny after the flawed lethal injection a year ago of convicted murderer Clayton Lockett, who received midazolam and was seen twisting on the death chamber gurney after medical staff improperly placed the IV line. This has been FPP Radio News, online at fppradio.com.
College roommates continue their bonding process until real friends are made, and a teacher hopes they never Google him. It's time for the weekly video feature that's heartier and more comforting than a heaping bowl of mom's butternut squash soup. This is the Onion Week in Review. Longtime James F. Blaine Elementary School teacher Suzanne Pomponio told reporters today that she could not believe how much fatter her second graders are getting. Pomponio estimates that each and every one of her kids must be 8 to 10 pounds heavier than anyone in her 2011 class, adding, quote, "and those kids were pretty fat too."
Honestly, I didn't think it was possible that this year's kids could be fatter than last year's, but they are. I mean, short kids are fat, tall kids are fat, and there's a smell. I don't really know how to describe it.
Local dad Michael Corain navigated several discount travel websites today with a precision reminiscent of 18th century Viennese prodigy Wolfgang Amadeus Mozart composing a symphony.
This is the Onion News Network.
This is Free Talk Live. Welcome to the program. You are invited here to take control of the airwaves and bring up whatever you might want to discuss. Joining you in the studio tonight, it's Ian.
Derek J.
And, of course, you can join us here on the radio waves. Our toll-free number is 855-450-FREE. And you can also join us via Skype at Skype username lrn.fm. Now, I believe that I mentioned this briefly last night, but we really didn't get into it on our live Sunday show. So let's talk twerking, Derek J.
Oh, my.
I don't know if you have ever twerked.
Sure, I have.
You have? Okay. See, I have not done the twerking. It is not necessarily something I'm interested in doing, but it seems to be a big thing with the young people these days. The young females.
You sound like a grandpa.
Young females, yeah. Most likely.
Yeah, people have been twerking for a long time. This
have
is
they?
Not new. Yeah, like if you look in some old Beastie Boys videos and stuff, you'll see some twerking from the 80s.
Was it called that back then?
I don't think so. I don't think the term was there. But it all became a big thing when Miley Cyrus did it. I think now it gets a name. I don't know. Maybe it's had a name the whole time. I don't even really know.
Yeah, I
but it's been around.
We'll have to look into the history of the twerk because, you know, I obviously people have shaken their butts in the past, but this is a little different from your average rump shake, I guess you could say.
Yes, it is.
It's kind of hard to really describe, I guess, on the radio what twerking is. I mean, how would you best, could you possibly describe it? For our listeners who don't understand, who have not seen any footage of twerking.
No, I don't think I could do it in a friendly way.
So it has to do with the butt cheeks and, or the hips. Was it mostly a hip move?
Yes.
Okay. Yeah. So anyway, if you Google it, you'll probably find all kinds of videos of this happening. And apparently, some government goons in Moscow do not much like twerking. especially next to some sort of World War II memorial. A court in southern Russia has now sentenced three young women to brief jail terms for making a video showing them twerking next to a World War II memorial. Russia celebrates the 70th anniversary of the Allies' victory in the World War II next month, according to the Associated Press, an emotionally charged holiday the Kremlin has been using for propaganda purposes. The sentencing in the Novorossiysk District Court of a 19-year-old woman to 15 days in jail and two women in their 20s to 10 days in jail each comes after prosecutors launched a probe into a video showing a group of women twerking next to the memorial on the Black Sea. Twerking is a sexually provocative dance involving thrusting of the hips. I guess that's a decent
description of it. That's the definition that Google gives, too. They've got a dance to popular music in sexually provocative manner involving thrusting hip movements and a low squatting stance. I'd say that's
the most accurate, important to it. So prosecutors said in a statement Saturday, five women were found guilty of hooliganism, and two of them.
Russia's so big on this hooliganism. Mm-hmm.
Sounds familiar, right? That's the Pussy Riot thing.
That's exactly what happened to them.
They went after the band members, and they actually mentioned Pussy Riot here in this story, but that is the charge that sent two of the members of the punk band Pussy Riot to prison for 2 years for an impromptu protest at Moscow's main cathedral in 2012. So obviously they really sentenced the Pussy Riot girls a lot harder in this case than they did the twerking women.
Yeah, I'm sort of surprised. It seems light, just 10 and 20 days.
Well, I mean, that's pretty horrible for dancing, right?
Well, but relatively compared to the Pussy Riot girls were just dancing and performing music too, right? And didn't they get hundreds of days?
They got years. So like,
years
in prison.
Right. So on a scale, I mean, it looks like they didn't take this one as seriously.
Well, I mean, now I don't know where this particular monument is, but I presume it's outdoors in a public place, whereas Pussy Riot did go inside the main Russian Orthodox cathedral, essentially, and sort of, even though it's open to the public, they obviously weren't wanted there to do an a cappella rendition of one of their songs.
This is hooliganism. They are right. Russia authorities are right about this.
Twerking is hooliganism?
This is hooliganism. If they're doing it on a statue, they are being hooligans. But they don't deserve jail for that.
No, I agree. And we'll come back and talk more about it here because there's a little bit more to say. I'm sure some people out there are thinking to themselves, well, that couldn't happen here in the United States, but oh, it can. And we'll talk about that too. Tim, though, is in Philadelphia. Tim, you're on Free Talk Live with Ian and Derek J.
Hey, thanks for taking my call.
Hey, Tim. Go ahead, sir.
Yeah, I had a question or a comment for Derek. Last week, you guys were talking about the public breastfeeding or women breastfeeding in public.
Yes.
And Derek, I was just curious who you were complaining to. Are you complaining to the women? Are you complaining to the business owners? Because, you know, I appreciate everything that you do and your activism, but it would seem like if what we're trying to do is spread the ideas of liberty, that we would be a little bit more tolerant of behavior that we didn't find classy, so to speak.
Well, Derek, before you answer the question, I don't think I was here for that conversation. Was that the show where it was you and Chris Cantwell?
Yeah, you weren't. Chris and Rich Paul.
That's right.
So what was the summary of what you were saying on the air at that time about breastfeeding in public?
I was saying that breastfeeding in public sort of falls outside of the realm of what libertarians typically talk about, which is like government should control this or businesses should control this. It's really just about social grace and tact and, you know, having respect for other people's feelings. That's sort of what manners are about, and that's what etiquette's about. And so I was making a statement about etiquette. I don't think I was complaining, caller, Tim in Philly. I think I was just pointing out a matter of social grace.
So wait, are you saying that women should not be able to? Or
No. See, that's the point. It's not a should be able to thing. It's not. It's not about control. It's about behavior in social situations.
Are like, you saying you feel
people have the freedom to? No, it's not. Well, people have. Yes, I think it's. I think it's not. I think it's not classy. Is what I said. It's like I think there are times and places to expose a breast, nipple, anything. There are places to be shirtless, parks, you know, in your home, private places that are comfortable. There's plenty of public places.
But in like
where
a restaurant,
it would be acceptable. Maybe some restaurants where it's okay to have your shirt off. But most restaurants, no. That's what I'm saying is like there's already rules about social convention. And women don't just get a pass because they're new mothers.
So it wouldn't bug you in a park, but if you were sitting in a restaurant, you would say something to
whom?
Yeah,
I am for I wouldn't say anything.
Okay.
I would endure it. I have tolerance, like Tim is suggesting here. You know, I would think it would be rude of me to go up and say something in that situation. It's not rude of me to just say it on the radio when it's like, this is not happening in front of me. This is I'm making a comment.
So, Tim, maybe you misunderstood. He was not saying he would go and say something.
Sure, sure. Listening to it like that, I get what you're saying more, but it just came off as you were being a little bit inconsiderate about people who felt differently than you. Because when you were talking about it last week, all I could think about was, well, some people may think it's uncomfortable when people smoke pot in a park, or they walk through an airport in their underwear, or you know, things like that. And I don't see anything wrong with those things. I don't see anything wrong with those things at all. Derek, I appreciate everything that you do.
Did you just get busted, Derek J? Because for our listeners that don't know, Tim is referencing some of the things that happened in your movie, Victimless Crime Spree, where in one scene you and Kelly Voluntarius go into the Manchester airport in your skivvies. And they are pretty skivvy. And I mean by that, very thin and small.
But people liked that.
Oh, I loved it. I thought it was hilarious.
I don't know.
But it's certainly true that some people could not like it.
I get that, yeah. I break social convention. I'm guilty.
Tim, okay, you got anything else?
Thank you very much.
Thanks for the call.
I appreciate you guys.
Thanks. Yeah, thanks, Tim.
All right, toll-free number here, 855-450-FREE. And it might also be considered inappropriate to twerk in an airport. But, you know, some people would like it. That's certainly true. We're talking about the twerking arrests and jailings in Russia, in Moscow, where three women have been sentenced to a couple of weeks in jail, two of them for 10 days, one for 15 days, for twerking near a monument. It's a memorial, a World War II memorial on the Black Sea. Prosecutors found them guilty, they said, rather, that they were found guilty of hooliganism. And two of the five, there were five charged, two of the five were spared jail because of poor health. Prosecutors said they were pressing charges against the parents of one underage girl who was twerking with the other girls for the, quote, failure to encourage the physical, intellectual, physiological, spiritual, and moral development of a child. I want to hear what you think about it. 855-450-FREE. Should twerking in public be a crime? It's Free Talk Live.
Molly's been having four scoops a day, and she has slimmed down and gotten this puppy look. Her coat has sheen. You can't believe it.
Oh, yeah.
Her breath is better. She's just perkier. It's just so totally amazing. She's a gorgeous Springer Spaniel. She's 12 and a half years old. The last 2-3 years, she was really becoming very old, very slow, was very sad.
I thought, oh, this is it.
I was driving along one day, and I heard this person raving about Dinovite. Dinovite.com.
Dinovite.com.
859-428-1000.
She's got life. She's got energy. She's got stuff to give.
She loves it. She chomps at every last single crumb.
These ingredients are natural. The flax and the yeast cultures and the grains.
The digestive enzymes that are cooked out of regular dog food.
We're on our third order now. We just want everybody to know about Dinovite.
859-428-1000.
859-428-1000.
Dinovite.com.
On the average, Americans work between 45 to 50 years, hoping to build up enough wealth to retire and live out their golden years. Unfortunately, with taxation, the rising cost of food, energy, housing, and medical, many retirees are forced to live below the poverty line. Is this a flaw of free enterprise, or is our monetary unit we call the Federal Reserve Note forcing us into perpetual debt, ensuring inflation and higher taxes? These questions and more can be answered by reading G. Edward Griffin's book, The Creature from Jekyll Island. Congressman Ron Paul states it's what every American needs to know about central bank power. A gripping adventure into the secret world of international banking cartel. Hi, this is Ted Anderson. I will give a silver dollar from the early 1900s to anyone who purchases this book. Call 1-800-686-2237 and order a copy today. It's critical that the public be made aware of the system. Call and order your copy today at 1-800-686-2237. That's 1-800-686-2237.
If you're looking for work, you know what I mean by
elevator speech. It's the short version, saying just enough to make the listener want to listen more. Even if you're not a job seeker, effective communication skills have never been more important, with money and attention so scarce now. So to cut through the clutter, choose every single word as though it was the last word the person you're speaking to will hear. Otherwise, it might be. Instead of saying, due to the fact that, say, because, and avoid mispronunciations. Say jewelry, not jewelry, which could offend. Undoubtedly, you don't want to say undoubtedly. And whatever you do, never use a preposition to end a sentence with. Just kidding. For more tips, hit survivalspeech.com. I'm Holland Cook.
Did you know that you can listen to and watch Free Talk Live during our live show 7 days a week from 7 to 10 p.m. Eastern via our studio cam at cam.freetalklive.com? Not only that, but you can also chat with other listeners at the same time. Do I need to mention that both the studio cam and chat room are totally free? Outside of Free Talk Live's live hours, you won't see a cam feed, but we'll hear audio from the Liberty Radio Network. So listen, watch, and chat all free at cam.freetalklive.com. That's cam.freetalklive.com.
New Hampshire is under quarantine as walking corpses devour the flesh of the living. Max is 11 years old and surviving alone. Slow-moving and non-thinking, the dead swarm his home. Now he must apply his Porcupine Freedom Scouts training to improvise his escape. Look for Survivor Max on Facebook, read reviews on Amazon, or read Chapter 1 at SurvivorMax.com.
You're listening to the best liberty-oriented audio streamed around the clock, on the air, and online. This is the Liberty Radio Network at LRN.FM.
We're back with more Free Talk Live. You can dial in toll-free. Share your thoughts with us about whatever you would like to talk about. That is the point of the program. We're talking about twerking right now, which apparently has gotten some young ladies in Russia arrested. And I realize that you might be thinking to yourself, well, that's Russia. It's a totalitarian dictatorship. That's just how Russia is. I mean, why is this even relevant? Well, because the same thing essentially happened right here in the United States just a few years ago in Washington, D.C. Derek J., I'm sure you remember where you weren't there for it, I don't think, but there were multiple activists, liberty-minded folks who went down to, I believe it was the Jefferson Memorial.
Yep.
Our very own Meg McLean was there. Adam Kokesh was there. A number of people were there at this Jefferson Memorial. I think it was Jefferson's birthday, actually. And they were celebrating Jefferson's birthday by putting in their own headphones. So they had their own music on whatever MP3 player or cell phone. So each participant was listening to something different. So it wasn't one particular song. They were each listening to their own tunes, and they were dancing at this Jefferson Memorial. And the police arrested them in a very violent manner. I mean, Adam Kokesh got body slammed into the pavement on this particular incident. And it was a shocking thing. Now, I don't recall. I think, did they drop the charges? I don't recall what happened. They must have dropped the charges in that case, ultimately.
So, yeah, but it was fuzzy. I never really found out what was the conclusion to the Jefferson Memorial dancing charges. Yeah, maybe someone else knows.
I just don't remember. I might have found out, but it's been so many years. It's probably been 5 years since that happened.
I seem to recall something about requiring like drug testing and all of the participants refusing.
Wow.
Something just basically like, nope, we're not going to do that.
So I don't. So
they were at a stalemate.
I don't think there was a jail sentence in that case.
No.
Beyond maybe however long they were held in custody for processing after they were arrested. But, you know, so you could point out that in Russia, these women have gone to jail for this. But on the other hand, it's pretty awful to be arrested simply for dancing. And that has happened here in the United States, right there in the capital city of Washington, D.C. So don't think for a moment that a twerking arrest couldn't happen here, too. If you went to the Jefferson Memorial and started twerking, you could very well get arrested as well.
Is that still a crime?
Dancing at the Jefferson Memorial?
They'll still arrest people for that?
I don't know. I mean, I don't see why they wouldn't.
I don't know. It just seems like they should give up after a while.
Well, they don't have any penalty for arresting people, right? Like, they arrest you to get you out of there. Even if they know that the charges aren't going to stick, they can still arrest
right.
you to
okay.
move you along and
I get
you
it.
Away from the scene.
Yeah, so that's the point, is they just drop the charges later. The point is they can just pick up your body and move it somewhere else.
Yeah, that's exactly right. And I guess, I don't know what their official position was on it. Was that it was, what, disrespectful to be dancing near a memorial? Well, different people have different ideas as to what's respectful. Maybe they felt the best way to celebrate his birthday was with a silent dance party. So this absolutely can happen here, and it is happening in Russia as well, where women have been sentenced to jail for twerking. In fact, according to the AP, it is a second twerking scandal in Russia, is what they're calling it, a scandal, in less than 2 weeks. Investigators last week launched a probe into a dance school in the city of Orenburg after a YouTube video of female schoolgirls dressed as bees and twerking in a sexually suggestive Winnie the Pooh routine sparked outrage.
What?
It's pretty amazing.
Russia, yes. Calm yourselves.
The dance school was temporarily shut down while officials in the southern city not far from the Kazakh border ordered an inspection of all dance schools in the region.
Wow. Dancing. This is Footloose.
It really is. And I mean, we shouldn't be surprised. This is the same country where being gay is also apparently illegal now. I don't know
yeah,
if you've heard about that.
Yeah, not just being gay, like wearing rainbow. And
really?
Yeah, because it's considered homosexual propaganda to be like wearing rainbow.
I know.
Have a rainbow flag.
There's a problem with like real hooligans, like punks, going
yeah.
around and targeting people that they think are gay and attacking them in Russia. And so these people are feeling more emboldened because the laws behind them. There actually are laws against gayness in like, Russia. And so there's thugs on the streets who aren't your average cops. These are just, you know, the average thug, I guess,
great.
That are attacking people for being gay. It's sick.
I don't even know what, I mean, I can't say move. That's not a good solution. That's what people tell me to do.
It's
know?
Hard,
like,
though.
Well, move. Go to some other place. But yeah, like, I've never been afraid of being beaten up for being gay. And
Thank
I live
goodness.
In the States, you know, and it's like, well, why wouldn't they want to move here? Like,
well, they can't. I mean, it's not an easy thing necessarily.
Yeah.
We know one guy who's actually here from Russia, and he is seeking asylum, some sort of a form of political asylum.
It's hard to move from Russia to the States?
It's like, hard to move from anywhere into the States. I mean, immigration is not an easy process. I think that the gentleman that we know is trying to get asylum, which may be a more accessible way of staying here for a time.
That's a good, you know, you could just be like, I'm gay. For asylum into the States from Russia.
I wonder if it would work.
Like, hey, you know, they're killing me over there.
I don't know what, you know, I've never looked into it, so I don't know what reasons you can seek asylum for. I know that he's seeking, like, for political persecution, but certainly being gay now
that's the
means
same
you're being
thing.
Politically persecuted.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I'm interested in knowing that. If you've ever sought asylum, if you know anything about that process, feel free to call in, share your thoughts with us here, share your experience at 855-450-FREE. And if you think that twerking should be illegal and that there should be, you know, no one should be able to dance in a sexually suggestive manner in a public place or even in a private place, I mean, we're talking about a dance school.
Yeah.
Where government agents have gone in, shut down the school, and then further ordered an inspection of all dance schools in the region just to make sure no one is twerking. Now,
hasn't it been like all new dance styles are somehow provocative to the generation past? Like,
yeah, I think
so. Oh my, they're getting closer together. Like, so everyone has to stop whatever the new dancing is.
I think you're right.
This is like police and politicians just saying, oh my goodness, wait, we can't approve of that. We have to shut all of them down. And meanwhile, weren't they dancing when they were teenagers?
Probably illegally, apparently. I mean, if you look at the old cabaret licenses in New York City, and I know that these exist in other cities. I know for a fact they exist in New York City. They still exist. You still can't have dancing in a club unless you have the appropriate license for it.
Okay, does that mean like, stripper dancing, or does that mean like people moving around in the bar as they please?
The latter. It means
what?
It means having a dance floor, having an area in which customers at a bar.
Because you're a cabaret.
If you're
a cabaret license,
right? If you have the cabaret license, you can have dancing.
This is the 20s.
That's about when that came out, and it still exists to this day. How enforced it is, I don't know, but we've heard about it within the last decade, so it's been enforced sometime in the last decade.
I imagine police could use it to put pressure on any clubs they don't like or anything.
Absolutely.
Anyone with a dance floor.
So this isn't new news. Dancing has always apparently, at least among political circles, been a subject of controversy, where people in politicians are willing to control it.
Just a couple of months in Utah, weren't there police showing up over a place not getting a license
for dancing?
Yeah,
that's right. That was a Halloween party, I think, in St. George, Utah, where the cops shut down a party over that. 855-450-FREE. Is dancing dangerous to your health? And more coming up. Free Talk Live.
You have all seen and heard about the elements of the periodic table. These elements are the building blocks of everything in the universe. You, my friends, are made from these elements. A shortage of any of these important trace elements can lead to disease. Go with the science and take the Lady Talk Health Challenge and get all 90 essential trace elements with a healthy start pack at LadyTalkLive.com. Or call 855-333-LADY. That's 855-333-5239.
Research shows it's not just what you put in your body that counts, it's what you put on it as well. Why not use an all-natural, healthy mineral-based makeup that actually benefits your skin? Once you experience the airiness and flawless coverage of Youngevity Mineral Makeup, you will never use anything else. With Youngevity, the perception of your complexion will be natural perfection. Animal-friendly mineral makeup at Mary Lou Health. That's MariLuHealth.com. Or call 855-321-HEALTH.
Free Talk Live.
I wish you would have answered the question as to what's the age range. I mean, if two 10-year-old boys are playing doctor with each other, and he was specific that he said it was okay for a boy and a girl to play doctor, which did happen to me when I was that age, but I was maybe two and a half, three years older than that girl. Am I a molester? She was the one trying to take my pants off. Should she go to jail?
You know, people like Lou, they get all upset over things like this when they're not even apprised of the facts. And you try to tell them the facts, and they just, since it doesn't fit with their worldview,
right,
it doesn't fit with their core belief system, it's just, it can't be possibly true that I could have possibly have known what I was doing.
Children who are engaged in sex with somebody who is older are being manipulated. That's one of them. And, you know, sometimes that's, sometimes that's true.
Absolutely. There's
and
no
sometimes
doubt.
Sometimes it's not.
Free Talk Live, 7 nights a week from 7 to 10 Eastern, live on the Liberty Radio Network at LRN.FM.
I love My Magic Mud. I drink a lot of coffee. I had stains on my teeth. Then I found My Magic Mud, and I was told it would remove stains. So I paid attention when I brushed the first time. My Magic Mud is black tooth powder, and the difference it made in my teeth in one application was noticeable. With four, my teeth were as white as you normal folks out there. Please go to MyMagicMud.com and buy a jar. There's 150 applications for $25. You can use Bitcoin. MyMagicMud.com. The three most important things you can do for Free Talk Live are, one, share one episode a week on Facebook or in some other social networking site. Two, buy the things you buy online through shop.freetalklive.com. Three, give $5 a month to the AMP program. You likely buy all kinds of things online. Amazon is the largest online retailer. You can get what you need at the same prices with free Super Saver shipping by going to shop.freetalklive.com. Please do your online shopping at shop.freetalklive.com.
Hi, I'm Derek J. I don't want a politician to represent me. To me, government is the idea that one group of people can coerce everyone to comply with an edict or face increasing punishments up to and including death. Despite perhaps the most noble of intentions, the best government services are a far cry from what could be provided for by voluntary interactions. Besides, the people who call themselves the government wage wars and put peaceful people in jail for crimes involving no victims. If Starbucks used some of its money to drop bombs, I wouldn't shop there. So why would I support the American Empire? The Empire does not require my consent.
Derek J's Victimless Crime Spree. Watch it for free and order the Director's Cut DVD at victimlesscrimespree.com. That's victimlesscrimespree.com.
While our satellite channel is free to listen to, it's not free for us. You can help us cover our satellite costs with a chip-in on the right side of the page at lrn.fm.
Free Talk Live. Dial on in toll-free here, 855-450-FREE. That's 855-450-3733, and you can join us online. Just drop on by freetalklive.com, where you can enjoy all kinds of features totally free. You create the content right there on the front page of the website. And other listeners can vote it up or down, whether they like or dislike. You can go and vote as well over at freetalklive.com. And ExpressCoin is the best choice for getting your cryptocurrencies of choice like Bitcoin, Litecoin, or Dogecoin. It's fast, safe, easy, and inexpensive. They're a licensed money services business. You can get your cryptocurrency with money order or check. Just start off at ExpressCoin.com. Whether you're in the U.S. or Canada, they can help you out. They've even got a smartphone app that you can download at ExpressCoin.com. But you don't have to do that. You can just go straight to the website as well. It's up to you. Different ways to use ExpressCoin.com. Whatever's easiest is what they want you to do. Use coupon code FTL and you'll save with no fee at all on up to $40 worth of cryptocurrency. So if you're just getting into Bitcoin, maybe it's your first buy, what better way to get your first Bitcoin than to pay no transfer fee on it? So go to ExpressCoin.com, use coupon code FTL. Whether you just need a little bit or a lot of Bitcoin, they can handle your order at ExpressCoin.com. Again, don't forget coupon code FTL. We're talking about dancing, which apparently is more illegal than a lot of people really realize. And I'm not just referring to Russia when I'm talking about this. Now, the story that sparked the conversation was that Russian women, several of them actually, had been arrested and three of them sent to jail. The only reason the other two weren't sent to jail is because apparently their health is not very good. So I guess the court went easier on them because
they're
sick.
Or their twerking was excellent.
And it's apparently the second twerking scandal in 2 weeks there in Russia. Another one involved dance schools, where you might expect twerking to be taught, perhaps. Apparently it is illegal to teach, or at least being heavily discouraged to teach dancing in these schools because the governments decided to shut down the schools so they could inspect them, just to make sure there wasn't any illicit twerking going on.
Where is it safe to dance anymore? I just saw there's like some movie about dancing in the Middle East, like Iran or Afghanistan, some underground dancing clubs.
Because it's illegal
out
there too?
Yeah, it's illegal there too. Is it illegal to dance everywhere? It's illegal in the States. You need a license.
It's shocking. I mean, it just doesn't even make sense. And maybe there's somebody out there who can explain this. Is the idea that dancing's bad for your health? Because it wouldn't seem to, that wouldn't make any sense. It seems like it'd be good for your health. Get you moving around, you know, a little cardiovascular activity. Is the idea that Jesus doesn't like dancing? Well, didn't Jesus say, like, dance? Didn't he invite, you know, isn't he
King
the Lord
David
of the dance
danced
or whatever?
No, he's right? Not Lord of the Dance.
Who's the Lord of the Dance?
That's an Irish show.
No, it's I know that it's like you're talking about the
the tap Odin
dance
or
show.
Something. Like there's some Greek god of dancing.
I remember in church camp singing a song about like Jesus dancing or something like that. Like Jesus.
I don't know. King David danced. He danced in his underwear, and King David
was
pretty important. Yeah.
So there you go. You should totally be able to dance in your underwear. If King David could do it, why shouldn't you be able to do it?
Right.
Here's a related story. Since I brought up the cabaret license, and just a real quick Googling of that reveals a story from September of 2014 by the Wall Street Journal, where a Brooklyn bar owner is apparently challenging New York City's cabaret law. If a customer at Muchmore's in Brooklyn so much as busts a move, owner Andrew Muchmore could be busted. New York City prohibits dancing in a venue unless it has a cabaret license. And Muchmore's, like lots of bars and restaurants across the five boroughs, does not have one. Now, Mr. Muchmore, who is also an attorney, is challenging the city's nearly 90-year-old cabaret law in federal court on the grounds that it violates freedom of expression and due process guaranteed by the First and 14th Amendments, respectively. A band is on stage nearly every night at the North Williamsburg Bar, which caters to a mostly young hipster crowd. But the fear of a fine has Mr. Muchmore steering clear of booking acts that might encourage his customers to sway. Quote, the only practical effect of the cabaret law is to prohibit dancing. In the majority of the city's eating and drinking establishments, the 33-year-old Mr. Muchmore wrote in a lawsuit that he filed last week in Brooklyn's U.S. District Court. In a statement, the city's law department said it would review Muchmore's claims when it receives the lawsuit. The City Department of Consumer Affairs enforces the cabaret law and is, quote, currently reviewing rules, laws, and regulations, many of which are in need of reform, including the cabaret law.
I think I've figured it out. I think this is it. If you have dancing like this guy wants to, it's going to make money for your business. It's obviously good business, right? So you want people to be able to dance at your business if you want to make more money. Then if you are a business owner and you know this, you're just going to pay off the people who require you to get a license for dancing because you're like, hey, I pay these guys off, I make more money, it's a done deal, right?
Mm-hmm.
But he doesn't want to pay them off or something. What's his hang up? Why doesn't he want to do that? Just because he feels like he shouldn't have to, or he doesn't have the money to?
It's actually pretty difficult is what he'll say here in a moment. The law does have its supporters, however. They maintain that the law is meant to ensure... This is, here you go, safety conditions.
Oh, baloney. No, it's venues. Extortion. It's the local gang, the city that's requiring this?
New York.
City of New York. New York City. Gang City requiring you to get their permission to dance.
Right.
So that, I mean, it's clear as day extortion. Like, oh, hey, it would be a shame if someone came in here and tore up the place if saw people dancing.
Muchmore says that obtaining the license is, quote, just unbelievably complicated and cumbersome. So that's why he doesn't want to go through the process. Depending on the venue, a license requires installing cameras, hanging video surveillance signs, and making regular appearances before a community board.
What?
So you have to go and appear in front of some unelected bureaucrats and what, justify your existence, justify the existence of your dancing, of your club having dancing? The cost of the license, by the way, ranges from as low as $150 to more than $1,000, depending on the venue's size and the duration of the license, which can be for up to 2 years. Critics of the law said it stifles nightlife options and creativity in the city. One such critic is Jim Glazer, who's the founder of the Costume Cult with two Ks. Arts Collective, which throws dance parties for upward of 1,000 people. Mr. Glazer said the law pigeonholes dancing to a few business owners who can afford a license. If officials, quote, want to shut you down, it's just one of the many excuses that they can pull out, he said. Some supporters are nightclub lobbyists who see the cabaret law as the cost of doing business. Mm-hmm. Robert Bookman, the counsel for the New York City Hospitality Alliance, representing bars and restaurants in the city, says, quote, it's available to anyone who rents or owns a space and installs the proper safety equipment that's required.
What safety equipment is required for people dancing?
Apparently video cameras.
What? Why?
I don't know how that's safety equipment, but I don't know, maybe if there's a fight on the dance floor or something like that, as though there couldn't be a fight without dancing?
Maybe they need to settle a dance off. The authorities need to watch all the video. Isn't that one of the things in New York City is the police need to be able to tap into private surveillance cameras anyway?
My goodness, I hope not.
I think that is the case. And so that would make a lot of sense if they were like, well, we need to have a video of everyone dancing.
If you want to spend the money in a place where it's properly zoned, anyone can get a cabaret license. So this person speaking isn't a bureaucrat. He's the representative of the Hospitality Alliance. So he's a spokesperson for essentially the bars and nightclubs in the city.
Yeah, he's with the in group.
Right.
They've all got their license.
The obedience group. Yes, yeah, exactly.
So he's got every incentive. Like however much the restaurant owners have paid for that permission is how much incentive he's got all total to prevent anything new from coming in, because there's going to be a lot more businesses he's going to get money from.
Yep, that's right. Muchmore here says that he believes the laws concerning liquor licensing, venue capacity, and noise ordinances all address safety issues at a venue such as his. Social dancing, he said, poses no such threat and therefore should not be regulated. The fine for unlicensed activities such as dancing without a cabaret license is $100 per day. Businesses that have a license but violate the law's provisions can face fines of up to $500, and the amount of fines collected has decreased in recent years. However, in 2005 and 2006, there were, $13,000, more than $13,000, and $43,000 the year after that in fines, respectively. We'll come back with more on this. It's Free Talk Live.
New Hampshire is under quarantine as walking corpses devour the flesh of the living. Max is 11 years old and surviving alone. Slow-moving and non-thinking, the dead swarm his home. Now he must apply his Porcupine Freedom Scouts training to improvise his escape. Look for Survivor Max on Facebook, read reviews on Amazon, or read Chapter 1 at SurvivorMax.com.
When the leading antihistamine and Nasacort go nose-to-nose, Nasacort wins, stopping more of the chemical responses that can cause your nasal allergy symptoms. And when you stop more causes, you get 24-hour relief from sneezing, an itchy runny nose, even congestion. It's prescription-strength medicine available over-the-counter. Nasacort Allergy 24-hour. Stops more of what makes you miserable. Use as directed.
If the IRS has garnished your paycheck or seized money from your bank account, you need to get professional tax help now. Fast action is required to put a halt to these aggressive IRS collection tactics. You can count on the knowledgeable team of tax professionals at Wall & Associates. With over 30 years of experience, Wall & Associates has settled the tax problems of thousands of taxpayers for a small fraction of what they owed. For a free face-to-face consultation, call 1-800-425-4610 to put a wall between you and the IRS. 1-800-425-4610 or look for us on the web at wallandassociates.net. We solve tax problems. If you hire Wall & Associates today, you'll never have to talk to the IRS again. To stop the levies and seizures today, take action now. Call Wall & Associates at 1-800-425-4610. Wall & Associates, 1-800-425-4610. Based on actual cases, results may vary, not a solicitation for legal services.
This alert just came in. This special announcement is for business owners and leaders of organizations who've been waiting for the right time to build. General Steel has made it impossible to wait any longer with rock-bottom prices that could save you thousands. That's right, General Steel, America's leader in pre-engineered structures, is offering buildings at prices you will never see again. Don't miss these prices. A 50 by 100 for under $30,000. You heard right. That's 5,000 square feet under $30,000. Manufacturers, if you need a larger building, try a 100 by 100 commercial building for $129,000. You can't afford to rent with these prices. Imagine a 70 by 100 foot church building for under $69,000. With the economy improving and interest rates still at historic lows, you can't afford to wait.
Call 800-917-8251. 800-917-8251. 800-917-8251.
If you want to know the latest about Free Talk Live before we go on the air, all you need to decide is how you want it delivered. It's your choice. Visit news.freetalklive.com. You can get emailed announcements and participate in contests via our email updates list. Plus, we have a Twitter account that you can follow and a Facebook page where you can become a fan. So visit news.freetalklive.com to get news about Free Talk Live as soon as it's announced and the way you want it delivered at news.freetalklive.com. That's news.freetalklive.com. Ross Ulbricht was convicted in early 2015 of running the infamous Silk Road Underground Market. The Silk Road was a gift to humanity and helped reduce the harms brought on by drug prohibition. For this good deed, Ross may be spending the rest of his life in prison. His family is planning to appeal his conviction, but they need your support. Please visit FreeRoss.org, where you can contribute via various methods, including Bitcoin. Ross needs your help now more than ever. Visit FreeRoss.org. That's FreeRoss.org.
Do you love Twitter? Make sure you favorite the LRN.FM Twitter account so you can receive our tweets at twitter.lrn.fm. That's twitter.lrn.fm.
It's Free Talk Live. you're invited here to dial in toll-free and share with us whatever you'd like to talk about. Our number is 855-450-FREE. That's 855-450-3733. Coming up, Derek J., you'll tell us a creative way that one artist in the, I think it was the UK, managed to get some potholes fixed.
Yes.
It's certainly something I've never heard of before, and some might find it a little shocking. And I think it ties in with our twerking discussion a little bit as well. So the toll-free number here is 855-450-FREE. We're talking about right now the cabaret license in New York City, which still exists, and it's the New York bureaucrats are still requiring people to jump through this particular hoop if they want folks to be able to dance at their business establishment. If you have a bar or some sort of a club and you're allowing dancing without a cabaret license in New York City, you could face fines of $100 per day.
What are you supposed to do? Go up to a couple, sir, madam, I see you dancing there, and we can't have that in our establishment. You see, we don't have a license
for that. I'm sorry, we're not licensed for this. Yeah, you're right. I mean, that would be what you'd have to have the security agent, the big black-shirted security guy, come up and put a stop to it, essentially.
Because stop moving like that.
Well, right. And then, of course, brings up the inevitable question. And I wonder if New York's laws actually define what is dancing, right? Is it toe tapping? Is it swaying your hips a little bit? I mean, at what point from standing still,
right,
do you become a dancer? What additions to standing still
rhythm
are required?
Just adding rhythm to
so if you have no rhythm, then it's totally okay.
Yeah.
See, I'd be curious to know what the bureaucrats think about that. And also, I'm also curious to know if there's an update in this case, because the most recent story here, there's one from January, but I'm not seeing anything else. I don't know if this case has even been heard yet. There's a story out of the ABA Journal. This is about the same man, Andrew Muchmore, who is challenging this this cabaret license, but it appears as though that case hasn't quite moved forward yet.
Does it say how much it is? Because I would like to know
how much the license is.
Yes. Is he doing this? He says he can't afford it, but I don't believe that. If the fine is $100 a night, the license for dancing can't be, I don't know, it can't be much more than a couple thousand, right?
I don't think he's saying he can't afford it. He's saying
it's out of principle that he's refusing.
Well, he says it's also unbelievably complicated and cumbersome to get this license. So it's not just going and, cutting a check to the city. It's also they got to come in, inspect the premises, make sure that you have cameras set up and some sort of sign warning people that they are on camera. And that's, I'm sure, just scratching the surface of it. This is just a Wall Street Journal article that obviously is not going to go into the gritty details of what all is required here. But it could be as much as, it says here that it's as little as $150 and more than $1,000, depending on square footage, basically, depending on some different factors.
So this is a weird one, because I agree with him that he shouldn't have to get this or whatever. It's cumbersome. I don't care. I don't think on principle he should have to submit to these weirdos who require him their permission to dance. But the way I do see it, if it is operating this way, then business owners who do get this license are doing the service of protecting their customers against city officials.
But it wouldn't be the customers who would be liable. The customers themselves would not be fined.
Oh,
it would be the
right
business owner who would take the brunt of it.
So the people who dance don't get in trouble. The business owner gets in trouble. So
that's
these
right
customers are liabilities to the business owners, right? They might dance.
Right.
So they're a liability.
Dance?
Yeah, of course.
Okay. I've never been to a hipster club before, so I figured I didn't know if they were too cool to dance or what the deal was with that.
Yeah, hipsters dance.
Okay. So this is a hipster bar, and so there's a very good chance that some of his customers will want to dance to the bands. And so
totally.
He said here he's been very carefully picking bands to which people would be less likely to dance.
Oh man, that is so sad.
So here's a little bit more information. So in 05 and 06, there was $13,000 and $43,000 in fines issued, respectively. However, there was only one violation issued in 2012 and none in 2013. So far, as of this was written in September 2014. At that time, there had been no citations issued either. So a decade ago, there were thousands of dollars in fines on this cabaret license, and in recent years, not so much. But the law is still there, and they certainly could enforce it at any time if they wanted to. In 2005, or from 2005 to 2014, there were 208 applications for cabaret licenses, according to the DCA, the administrative group. Of those, 177 of them, or 85%, were approved. There are 146 license holders in New York City.
That doesn't sound like very many.
No, it doesn't. I mean, given the size of New York City and the amount of bars and clubs that exist just in Manhattan alone, 146 license holders does not seem very, very high.
No, that's low.
If history's any indicator, Mr. Muchmore, the owner of the bar, faces an uphill battle in striking down that cabaret law. It has been in effect since 1926, and it even withstood a proposal in 2003 by former Mayor Michael Bloomberg to replace cabaret licenses with, quote, nightlife licenses.
What? He's the one who's ruining the nightlife in New York City.
Well, he probably already did, because he's gone now, right? They've got a new guy in.
Oh, I think.
According to historian Michael Lerner, the law was really a response to interracial mixing during Prohibition. Surprise, surprise.
Oh, no.
The police didn't care so much about drinking. What they cared about was white women dancing with black men.
Oh, can't have that.
This according to the historian who wrote Dry Manhattan, Prohibition in New York City. Attorney Paul Chevigny challenged the cabaret law twice, once unsuccessfully. In 1988, a state Supreme Court ruled that venues should be allowed to host live music without licensing restrictions on the grounds that music is protected as free expression. In 2007, Mr. Chevigny made a similar argument in an attempt to allow dancing without a cabaret license, but his suit failed. A complicating factor is a 1989 U.S. Supreme Court decision that found that social dancing doesn't constitute speech or expression under the First Amendment.
What?
The social dance community, said Chevigny, is not very well organized. Most of them don't want to spend their time arguing with bureaucrats. He joked that if lawyers liked to dance, the history would probably be different.
Oh, that's horrible. What a sad story. It's true. You know, people who like to dance don't form coalitions to protect dancing. You know, we just want to go out to a club and have fun.
And you'll find one. You know, you'll find one that will allow you to do that.
But, you know, there are bureaucrats who do get together all day and spend your money on finding ways to make it more difficult to dance. And I don't know why. Why would they spend their time this way? Because they get more money when they shake down businesses?
I didn't know also, by the way, about this Supreme Court decision. And yes, it is all about the money, I think. And obedience. They really like obedience. Some of them are really into that. But anyway, the...
It can't still be the racism thing of like, oh, we can't have integration.
I doubt that. Yeah, I think it's probably being enforced by people of different races at this point.
Right.
So this is just an old law that's still on the books, generating revenue for the city. They're not going to... If it's generating revenue, they're not... Because again, all of the license holders have to renew every 2 years.
Yeah. Hey, what do you know? This old racist law makes us money every year. I say we keep it.
Right. Well, I mean, there's bureaucrats' salaries who are getting paid by this law, right? If they eliminate this law, maybe they'll have to cut some jobs, and they certainly don't want to do that. So the Supreme Court decision, I have to say, is pretty shocking. From 1989, finding that social dancing doesn't constitute speech or expression under the First Amendment.
Not even interpretive dance? What if you're interpreting the Bill of Rights
with
your dance?
Yeah, that's a good question. I mean, what about a mime? I mean, is a mime not expressing himself? Do you have to actually try to speak? Do you have to try to emit words and sounds in order to have free expression? What about mute people? I mean, shouldn't they be able to dance in the way or to express themselves with their bodies in the way that they see fit?
Yeah, dancing is absolutely expression. I don't know why. It could be an expression of joy. Like I was bringing up the example of King David. I don't see why the dancers, if they did form a coalition, couldn't use some sort of religious argument from that direction, right? Like we have a religious right. Yeah, maybe it's not protected as a form of free expression. Okay, Supreme Court.
Sure,
but we've got you on this other. Yeah, it's from religion.
Yeah, I think that's an interesting way to approach it, because certainly there are churches where there's the more fun kind of like black churches where people will get up and actually dance. I don't know if there's any white churches that do that, but
mine was, but it was kind of lame. They called them like progressive churches.
Oh, really?
Yeah. But it was still pretty lame.
No, but better than just sitting in pews and just standing
up.
Yeah,
they had
right?
like guitars and drums and stuff and supposed to be dancing.
So there's more to come here tonight on Free Talk Live, including Wanksy, Not Banksy, but Wanksy, a new artist, has hit the scene in the UK, and we'll explain more about what he's done to actually help get some potholes filled around his town. Our toll-free number is 855-450-FREE. It's pretty creative. I got to hand it to him. 855-450-FREE is the number here tonight. Plus, some actual good news coming out of the Supreme Court about police dog searches. That's all on the way. Plus, your calls about whatever you want. It's Free Talk Live.
Kid, this facility is like a ship. So how do I keep us on course without micromanaging every detail? Easy, with Grainger. Grainger's online tools help give me the visibility I need. I can shop, order, and manage all our activity. Oversee purchases, control costs, all while you guys get to order what you need when you need it. I run a tight ship, kid. I run it with Grainger. Get it? Got it? Good. Learn more at Grainger.com/online purchasing. Grainger, for the ones who get it done.
Here's a good idea. When you have a legal matter like creating your will or legally setting up a business with a corporation or LLC, you don't necessarily need a law firm. Use LegalZoom.com. At LegalZoom.com, you answer straightforward questions online and they take care of the rest. They even review your answers for common mistakes and guarantee your satisfaction. Free Talk Live listeners, you'll get 10% off your order by typing in FTL in the referral box at purchase. Don't procrastinate with these important legal documents. LegalZoom.com. LRN.FM needs your help getting our satellite signal back on in Africa. Our satellite provider had us on at no charge from 2012 through February of this year when they pulled the channel off the air. Now we're trying to raise $22,000 to continue reaching people with the message of liberty in places where it's needed most. Please visit our Indiegogo fundraiser at africa.lrn.fm. Give what you can and share the link with your friends. africa.lrn.fm.
Here's a chance to do a little activism while you're cruising Facebook, Twitter, or Google+. Between the LOL cats, the recipes, the hot girls, and the inspirational sunrise memes, Free Talk Live's post pass by your newsfeed. Like them. Comment. It gives us more exposure. If you don't see our posts, click like at facebook.freetalklive.com and then hover over it to click get notifications. It's an easy way to spread the ideas of liberty a bit further. I know you're busy, but you can spare that tenth of a calorie it takes to click on something. facebook.freetalklive.com.
You're listening to the live edition of Free Talk Live. Hour number two is next, after the news, here on the Liberty Radio Network at LRN.FM.
From Keene in the Shire, the Liberty Media capital of the world, this is Daryl W. Perry, host of FPP Radio News for Monday, April 27th, 2015. Silver is trading at $15.87 per ounce. Gold is valued at $1,187 per ounce. And according to BitcoinAverage.com, the average price of Bitcoin is $219. Antiwar.com reports for the Senate Republican majority to get enough votes for a series of anti-Iran amendments to an upcoming bill, which itself aims to block the Iran nuclear deal, they're going to need support from a number of Democrats. The strategy right now among Republican leaders is to try to coax the Democrats on board by adding a number of measures about Israel in the hopes that fear of angering the powerful Israeli lobby will oblige them to support the legislation. Dozens of amendments are expected, with many focusing on demand for Iran to publicly endorse Israel and for the administration to affirm that Iran is sufficiently pro-Israel to ease sanctions on them. There's an interesting split here, however, as AIPAC, one of the most powerful groups in this lobby, is openly opposing these efforts to make the bill more explicitly about Israel. It's unsurprising AIPAC should feel this way. After all, Israel and its lobbyists have been working tooth and nail to kill a diplomatic settlement with Iran, but that doesn't mean they want to have their name splattered all over the bill that does it. The hope among Senate hawks is that killing the deal is a prelude to a big war, and the last thing AIPAC needs is for Israel to be so directly responsible for that. For over 35 years, Robertson Roberts has been a trusted source for buying and selling your investment-grade precious metals. They also take Bitcoin for precious metal purchases and permanently removed the minimum purchase order for all orders paid in the digital currency. Call Robertson Roberts today for knowledgeable advice on investing and a forward-thinking approach to new technologies. 850-478-5270 or online at rrbi.co. UPI reports a Russian court jailed and fined a group of women who filmed themselves twerking in front of a World War II memorial on the country's Black Sea coast. Prosecutors sentenced Margarita Radichskaya to 15 days in jail for petty hooliganism, along with two other women who received 10-day sentences. Two additional women were fined, while the parents of a sixth dancer, who is under the age of 18, face fines and monitoring over charges of failing to perform parental duties for raising minors. The six can be seen in a YouTube video that was published on Friday performing a synchronized dance that at times utilizes twerking, a form of dance involving low squatting and hip thrust. A large memorial marking a 1943 battle in which the Soviet Army captured the area from Nazi forces looms in the background. The women said they filmed the video as a promotion for a dance class at a local school. Prosecutors said the erotic and sexual twerk dance was disrespectful to those who died in the conflict. The incident also follows a national scandal over a YouTube video of girls from a dance school twerking while dressed in striped leotards, miniskirts, and stockings. The video, which has been viewed over 23 million times, resulted in the cancellation of the twerking classes at the school and an investigation by Russian authorities as to whether a debauched action took place. FPP Radio News is brought to you by Coinbase. Coinbase is a simple and secure online Bitcoin wallet for sending, receiving, and storing Bitcoin. Coinbase also allows you to buy and sell Bitcoin using a bank account or use their tools to accept Bitcoin as a merchant. Coinbase has more than 1 million consumer wallets and is trusted by over 25,000 merchants, including Overstock.com, Khan Academy, Reddit, and of course, FPP. Get started at coinbase.fppradio.com. Reuters reports the U.S. Supreme Court is set to hear arguments this week on whether a drug used in Oklahoma's lethal injection mix should be banned in a case that comes as the shortage of execution chemicals has sent some states scrambling for alternatives. The main question before the nine justices in the case brought by three death row inmates that will be heard on Wednesday is whether the use of the sedative midazolam violates constitutional protections against cruel and unusual punishment. The case does not address the constitutionality of the death penalty in general, but brings fresh attention to the debate over whether executions should continue in the United States. Executions in Oklahoma came under great scrutiny after the flawed lethal injection a year ago of convicted murderer Clayton Lockett, who received midazolam and was seen twisting on the death chamber gurney after medical staff improperly placed the IV line. This has been FPP Radio News, online at fppradio.com.
From the admission of ant colony 00008256 7 KLN 00067X into the Union in 1897 to the day in 1817 when embarrassed construction workers realized they put the Erie Canal in the wrong place, The Onion looks back at this week in history. On August 5th, 1962, Nelson Mandela was jailed until 1990, becoming fully rehabilitated through the South African penal system. And thanks to the services provided to him while imprisoned, emerged from jail a successful politician and internationally revered symbol of peace. Mandela's record of overcoming hardships and moving South Africa beyond its formidable racial struggles is a lasting testament to South Africa's correctional facilities and prove that the penal system's small cells, demeaning work duties, and minimal rations are exactly the tools needed for a prisoner to truly become a reformed citizen.
This is the Onion News Network.
This is Free Talk Live. You can dial toll-free and bring up anything that you want right here at 855-450-FREE. That's 855-450-3733. Whether it is illegal twerking in Russia or illegal dancing in New York City, that's what we talked about in the first hour. The we being me, Ian.
And Derek J.
And, of course, you can get more of Derek J. on his website.
FlamingFreedom.com. You should go to Flaming Freedom. For this episode, okay. I think that's the one I want to talk about today.
The other one's still up, though.
Yeah, the other one's still up. But so, you should go to FlamingFreedom.com for another show.
Totally should. It's a great show. It's a once-a-week program that you and Dale and some other folks who...
Yeah, a rotating guest of co-hosts.
Some more flaming than others.
Yeah, all LGBT, LMNOP, all the rest of the letters of the alphabet.
sometimes some straight people. I've heard one or two straight co-hosts guests or at least or
that's
whatever,
right.
on Flaming Freedom. Anyway, you guys get into some real kind of sexy topics.
We
on
talk
Flaming
about
Freedom.
Twerking.
More than that. A lot more than that. More than we can possibly even say on national radio, you talk about on Flaming Freedom.
Right.
At flamingfreedom.com. And MP3 downloads available? Yes.
Yes.
Okay, good.
And it's on video.
Oh, yes. With underwear.
There's always video. Underwear.
Yeah. Flamingfreedom.com. All right, let's continue here. You can bring up anything that you want. Derek J., you wanted to talk about a story that you pulled from the front page of freetalklive.com. And as we've mentioned, our listeners can go there and vote on things and also submit content. So this is the second story on the front page right now, submitted by Stem Dokken. What is going on in the UK?
Well, apparently a mystery road artist has been drawing pictures of penises around potholes in Bury, Greater Manchester, as a way to get the council to fix them. They, the potholes, don't get filled. They'll be there for months, says the artist, who goes by the name of Wanksy. People will drive over the same pothole and forget about it. Suddenly, you draw something amusing around it, and everyone sees it and gets it reported and fixed. He says his drawings have meant the potholes get fixed more quickly, although Bury City Council says that they already had a plan in place to deal with the issue.
It's a coincidence. A total coincidence.
A spokesman for the council has, he describes Wanksy's artwork as obscene and urges him to stop his painting.
Now, quote, is he anonymous? People don't know who he really is?
Apparently, okay. I don't think, Wanksy is public. Quote, the actions of this individual are not only stupid, but incredibly insulting to local residents, the Bury Council spokesman says. Has this person for just 1 second considered how families with young children, must feel when they are confronted with these obscene symbols walk to school?
We've had this actually happen here in Keene, New Hampshire. I don't know if you recall, last year during the Chalk War, there was a large penis that was drawn out in front of one of the businesses in downtown Keene. And someone, there's a local guy who's sort of a local politically active guy who actually witnessed the people who were drawing this. And he said it wasn't someone that he knew of to be a Free State Project participant or a liberty activist.
I would be surprised, yeah.
I would be too. But nonetheless, I was still somewhat amused by it just because, look, it's just a chalk drawing of a penis. I mean, this is not the end of the world. This is not a big deal. I mean, if you've talked to your kids about penises and vaginas, then there's one in chalk on the pavement. I mean, why is it such a big deal to people when they see this kind of stuff? I mean, I guess
don't know, because it's culture, because we come from a prudish Puritan culture. Because when I go to Europe and Greece and Italy, there are penises all over the place and nobody cares.
When you say all over the place, I mean, what does that mean?
On statues, on paintings, on walls, in pieces
public.
Of art.
And
you can buy little statues that have penises on them. I mean, big deal. Everybody's over it. I mean, it's been all of our ancestry in human history that we've had these
we've
things.
We've had penises for a long time.
It's not new, and people freaking out about it being in a piece of chalk is that's what's outrageous to me, and I think it's totally the puritanical culture.
It's where
we come from. It's because it's not the rest of the world that treats penises like this.
That's a good point. And you know, with the paintings and sculptures, arguably the penises there are more realistic, right? I mean, those in most cases are, unless it's some sort of surrealist painting, it's usually generally as close to photorealistic as the artist can possibly get.
As the rest of the body.
Right. So why would a chalk penis be as offensive as those penises? I'm not saying one should be more offensive than
I think
another,
it's because of location, right? Like in a museum or in a place where you would expect works of art, even down a city street where you might expect works of art, seeing a penis there might not be a big deal. But when you're walking past a business that you're not used to it, or, you know, I don't know, you're talking about a place that's a little more family oriented, maybe they would be offended by that. I can see why there is a time and a place for these types of drawings.
Yeah, I can understand why a business owner wouldn't want to have some salacious drawings out in front of their place of business. It certainly should be their property rights, and they should be able to determine those things. Unfortunately for the business owner, the property in question, at least in this case, in Keene with the chalking, was in front of their business, which is a downtown business, which means that the sidewalk is not actually owned by the business owner. It's public property. So, you know, yeah, they should have control over the front of their business, but unfortunately the city prevents them from doing that, which is one of the reasons why there's a panhandling problem. Apparently here in Keene, there's been some discussion about creating a panhandling ordinance to prohibit people from doing that, but the city attorney actually came back with the right response to the city council, which was, look, you can't do this. You can't prohibit someone asking another person, hey, can I have some money? Because it's a clear free speech violation to do that. So I think they've backed down on that. But as I pointed out on a recent blog post at freekeen.com, if business owners actually had the rights to the sidewalk in front of their business and further the parking spaces as well, if business owners, the property owners, had that property right,
they'd be more beautiful, for one.
Well, yeah, and they could take care of it in the way they felt was appropriate. So maybe the head shop with the porn store in the back wants to allow chalk penises out front, but the family-friendly McDonald's or the candy store downtown might not want to allow chalk penises. So each business owner would get to determine how the property was taken care of. And of course, not having the government run the parking would also mean that we'd have a marketplace of ideas handling the parking situation as well. Mm-hmm. I think private property is the solution there, because then a business owner could prohibit a panhandler from being out front of their business. Whereas right now, because it's public property, there's a panhandler can stand out there all day long and there's nothing the business owner can do about it.
I really prefer if business owners would own the sidewalks in front of their places, because I imagine it would be more colorful as well. They wouldn't just choose one drab slab
gray
of sidewalk. Yeah, they would like make it colorful. Like McDonald's would probably choose red or yellow,
right,
and it would be cute. Anyway, Wangsi uses a similar argument to the one you brought up to defend his art. He says, quote, it's not an actual photograph of an anatomical part. It's a drawing. It's artwork. The naked body is a thing artists have painted for years. There are sculptures that don't wear clothes. It's artistic expression. To be offended by that, here's another city council spokesman. Thank goodness he has a little bit of sense. He says, to be offended by that, you must be very prudish.
Yeah.
Not only is this vandalism. See, oh, he's got a different reason to be upset
vandalism.
About it. See,
chalk it's, is vandalism. Wait, was
see,
it chalk?
Yeah.
He did chalk.
Oh, no. It seems to be paint.
Oh, actual paint.
Yeah.
Okay.
So it's like spray paint. So, he's got his own reasons to be upset by this. He's not prudish, though. Not only is this vandalism, it's also counterproductive. See, he's going to make the economic argument against Wangsi.
Well, I guess they do have to clean up the paint, right?
No, they don't, because look at these pictures. They don't even do that. They pothole over these things, or whatever you call it.
So they fill, right, them. So what you're showing me.
They're filling in the potholes, and then they don't even cover up the paint.
They did nothing. They did nothing at all. The penis is larger than the pothole, so the penis sort of almost surrounds or intersects the pothole.
Well, it has to draw attention to it. If it were in the pothole, it wouldn't work.
Good point.
So, but don't let him be dissuaded. He's going to make this argument anyway. Every penny that we have to spend cleaning off this graffiti is a penny less we have to spend on actually repairing the potholes. Well, that's not true, because you didn't spend a penny on it.
Apparently, I didn't spend anything. Yeah. All right, we'll come back with more here. You can share your thoughts. Plus, coming up, good news out of the Supreme Court. It doesn't happen that often, but there is a little bit of good news for in reference to drug dog searches. 855-450-FREE is our toll-free number. You can share your thoughts with us here on Free Talk Live. And also Skype us at lrn.fm.
Here's a special message for those of you who owe the IRS at least $10,000 or more in back taxes. The IRS has special programs in place that could eliminate or reduce your tax debt by thousands of dollars. Call the tax helpline that has been set up to help you. 800-691-6129. That's 800-691-6129. Stop the wage garnishments, levies, and tax liens now. Once you've qualified and enrolled, the IRS will stop all the collection activities against you. These unique programs have been allocated to help the economy and significantly reduce or eliminate your tax burden. The IRS is currently accepting reduced settlements and other favorable programs. You may qualify for substantial savings, so get the help you need. For free information and to see if you qualify, take down the number now for the Tax Representation Hotline. 800-691-6129. That's 800-691-6129. 800-691-6129.
Again, the Congressional Budget Office sounds the alarm. This time warns of Greek-style U.S. debt crises. You heard me right. The GAO is drawing a parallel between the U.S. economy, its debt, and the current Greek economic meltdown. With the debt-to-GDP chart climbing into unfamiliar territory, the growing budget deficit will rise to unsupportable levels. Hi, this is Ted Anderson. The Federal Debt and Risk of Financial Crises document the CBO has published is a must-read for every American. Covering the risk of continued deficit spending coupled with an aging population and the rising interest rates spell economic disaster. It's imperative that you get a copy of this document and study it for yourself. Call me today at 800-686-2237, and I'll send you a free copy. Again, call 800-686-2237 and ask for your copy of the CBO document. Once again, you need to read this government report. Call 800-686-2237.
Free Press Publications is an independent, alternative media and publishing company founded in June 2009 with the mission of ensuring a free press for the freedom movement and is committed to spreading the message of peace, freedom, love, and liberty. FPP also gives new authors an avenue for publishing freedom-oriented material. FPP brings you daily news and commentary on the website fpp.cc, as well as a daily 5-minute newscast, FPP Radio News, and weekly news, views, and commentary in the FPP Freedom Minute and Peace Love Liberty Radio at fppradio.com, and the monthly newspaper FPP News at news.fpp.cc. Find FPP online at fpp.cc. That's fpp.cc, as in Creative Commons.
So you've heard all 3 hours of the latest episode of Free Talk Live, and you're still hungry for liberty-oriented audio content? Did you know that we have another 24/7 audio stream at lrn.fm? The Liberty Radio Network airs the latest episodes of some of the best liberty-oriented podcasts on the internet, around the clock. In addition to recorded content, you'll also hear live shows like Free Talk Live, originating from our Keene, New Hampshire studio. So listen anytime at lrn.fm. That's lrn.fm.
If you're a liberty and freedom-oriented American, come to the 3rd Annual Arizona Freedom Fest at Schatz Ranch Shooting Range May 1st through May 3rd. Fun for the whole family. Lots of stuff for the kids and lots of great guest speakers and events for everyone. Food, music, shopping, and more. Speakers include Sheriff Richard Mack, Derek Grayson, Joel Skousen, and many more. Plenty of camping room at Schatz Ranch. For tickets or more info, go to ArizonaFreedomFest.com. That's the 3rd Annual Arizona Freedom Fest at Schatz Ranch May 1st through May 3rd.
Listen to LRN.FM on any phone, anytime. 213-493-0309. That's 213-493-0309.
We're back with more Free Talk Live. You can take control of the airwaves here at 855-450-FREE. We're talking about chalk penises.
Paint penises.
Oh, I'm sorry. Yes, you're right. Paint penises that have been painted over and on top of and through, basically, the potholes.
To draw attention to the potholes in the road.
And where was this? Was it London or some town?
In Greater Manchester.
Oh, Manchester. In England.
Yes, in the UK. Bury.
Bury. So the painting had been done. This artist Wanksy said he wanted to draw attention to the pothole problem. I mean, this is not just something that happens in Manchester. It happens in a lot of places. Certainly here in New England, bad roads. Roads go worse. They get worse faster when they're in cold weather. From mm-hmm. what I understand, it has to do with the expansion and the contracting of things. You know, physics.
Water.
Yeah,
water like breaks them apart. I thought it gets into the cracks and then expands.
I think it's also the ground as well. I don't know if it's.
I guess so.
Yeah, I think probably both of those things, like the ground shifts or whatever, and with temperature changes, things expand and contract naturally, not just the water, but. Anyway, it's called frost heaves.
Yeah, and you also can't really repair the roads until it's warm enough weather.
Not
right?
effectively.
So if it's really cold where you are, there isn't there aren't that many opportunities to fix the roads.
Of course, the I think a big question that should be asked is, well, you know, what kind of cool road technology would we have if we didn't have the government taking care of the roads?
Cool road technology would be anti-road technology. It'd be flying cars.
Well, not everything can fly, right? Like, I mean, cargo planes would probably be a lot more expensive to operate than 18-wheeler trucks, for instance.
Yeah, I guess you're right.
So, I mean, there's probably going to be, at least for the foreseeable future, a use for roads. But what we haven't had happen, Derek J., is the marketplace hasn't really been competing in the realm of roads. Like, there could be some kind of thing other than blacktop, you know, this tar-based stuff that they put down.
I don't know. It's pretty good.
You think so?
I mean,
it's old tech, isn't it? I mean, this is decades-old technology.
Yeah, but so is the wheel. I mean, that's old tech, and we use that for roads. I'm just saying, asphalt or blacktop, whatever it is, it's rocky. You get a lot of traction with rubber. Mm-hmm. It's cheap, you know, easy to produce and easy to work with.
It's not cheap when the government puts it on, though. I mean, they pay too much for it.
Like, there's this new type of technology. I don't know if you've heard about it, but they've got these machines that can roll over roads and repair them, like, as they go. So it's like this one big wide machine goes over the road.
Oh yeah, I've seen
it
a picture.
It chops
of that.
Up the existing road and, like, chunks it up and mixes it up with a couple of stuff.
There are
other ones that lay bricks as well, but this is just a recycling of the existing road, and it only adds, like, I don't know, 30%. It's like 30% of the cost or whatever to just, like, lay down a new road. Mm. So it makes economic sense. Yeah. I don't know why more city governments aren't, like, jumping onto this as an opportunity unless they get some sort of kickback from the asphalt companies or something. I don't know.
No, I would guess normally it's the asphalt companies that are getting the money out of the city councils, right? Like, they're... I don't know.
I don't know how it works. I just know that this technology exists to recycle roads. It seems like a no-brainer to me, and it's not a big thing, like, anywhere yet.
Share your thoughts here toll-free at 855-450-FREE. So is there more about the painted penises? You got Wanksy the artist over there, not to be confused with Banksy.
Yeah, and we got the offended city council over here. Not the not prudish one. There was the prudish one at the beginning. And now this guy, he's making his economic argument, saying that... well, you know, every penny that we have to spend cleaning off this graffiti is a penny less we have to spend on actually repairing the potholes. Wanksy, see, you're causing trouble. People are entitled to express their grievances to the council, but offending the public and wasting their council tax is not the way to resolve the situation. We understand and accept that residents are unhappy with the number of potholes in the borough, and we have a program of scheduled works to fix them.
Mm.
See? So
we'll
he's got
right
a plan.
Yep.
Yes. Fear not, submitizens. We've got the plan.
Well, what do you think, Derek J? I mean, I'm sorry. I guess I misunderstood the story in the beginning. I, for whatever reason was in a chalk mindset.
It's paint. Yes.
It's paint. That definitely is more of like a vandalism kind of thing. I mean, do you feel like Wanksy has done something wrong here?
No.
So you're okay with even painting these things? Like, to me, it wouldn't have bugged me if it was chalk, but paint might be going a little bit too far.
I don't know. I think this is like a nuanced one. Like, if I were going to be strictly libertarian here and stand by principles, I would say, no, you know, it's government property. I view roads, like, unlike most people who see it as, well, it's public property. I'm public and I have every right to use it. I disagree with that. And I see this as government property. And I really try and, like, the roads are lava. I really try and not use them. And I try and not step on any government property because I want them to respect my property, where I say, no, you can't enter my property and I won't enter yours. We can have this little, like, detente, right? We can coexist and keep it peaceful.
So you're saying if you think it's government property, then you would respect it and not support
painting? If I were standing on principle, yeah, that would be my position. But honestly, I'm saying no, I don't care. I think it's funny and go ahead and do it. It's great. It did draw attention. It did get the potholes fixed. See, and how else is he going to do it?
I think that I think you can also make an argument from principle that this is okay.
How so?
And I think the argument is that government property isn't legitimate property, that it is, you know, whether you call it public property or government property, it's, in my opinion, whatever it is the people calling themselves government have, whatever it is they claim to possess, whatever they claim to have ownership over, they yeah. don't. That it's actually public, that it's actually owned by everyone or owned by no one. But either way, it's certainly not owned by them, because a thief cannot own the bicycle that he stole from you. That's still your bike. The thief yeah. stole it. Same thing with money. If the thief comes into your home and steals your money and then goes and, you know, paves a road with it, that's still not the thief's road. That's your road at that point, because, you know, you have a claim to it. A rightful claim.
It's a slippery slope either way. I see where you're coming from, but it's a slippery slope either way.
And if it's your road, you have the right to put paint on it.
Yes, I follow.
So that's my principled argument for you.
I get it, but it's still... Don't you see that that would lead to, like, the downfall and degradation of all sorts of roads? Like, you know about the tragedy of the commons.
Yes,
so
yes.
if people treated all things as if they really were the commons, they would go too bad.
Which might encourage people to not make them common anymore, right? Like, if they, if you can show people the tragedy of the commons and explain it to them.
There has to be another way without the destruction, is what I'm hoping for.
But yeah, you support this.
Yeah. It's funny.
It is funny, and I agree with you. And I feel like you could make the argument that if you know, if you want to paint a penis on the road, you should be able to. And if somebody wants to come along and paint over it, they should be able to as well. Have you ever seen one of those graffiti walls in California? Once I was at Venice Beach when I was out at a conference for a talk radio. We took a break and went out to the beach with a friend. Just kind of walked around. I'd never been out there before. And they actually have a wall, several of them, a few different ones of these things where. I don't know what the size of it is, but it's a wall that's large enough to where three or four men can stand on either side of it. And so you've got like one or two guys on this wall pretty much at all times during the day, just graffitiing, just constantly graffitiing.
Cool.
So over the period of a week or however, maybe it's just a couple days, I don't know, but it won't take long for every single piece of graffiti on that wall to be covered up with more graffiti.
Yeah.
And it's a cool kind of like art, like a public art installation. But it's also tragedy of the commons in a way. It's Free Talk Live.
By now, you may have heard a bit about Bitcoins. But did you know Bitcoins are now over an $8.5 billion market? And did you know that over 65,000 businesses now accept Bitcoins? Listen, if you're already earning Bitcoins or trying to make money in the Bitcoin market, you've got to know BidBit.co. Why? Because BidBit.co is where you can easily receive Bitcoins by selling and auctioning off your own personal items or promote business products and services for Bitcoins. You heard right. Whether personal or business, you can now buy, sell, and auction your product and services quickly, easily, and securely for Bitcoin at BidBit.co, the first and only marketplace website to offer BidBit escrow, a proprietary technology which gives buyers and sellers security and peace of mind because all transactions are protected. Start today. It's free to join, free to post, free to auction, and free to bid at BidBit.co. Buy, sell, bid, or auction everything Bitcoin. That's www.bidbit.co. BidBit.co.
On Free Talk Live, we're bringing people to the ideas of liberty every day. From wrestling superstars like Glenn Jacobs.
You guys really are having an impact, I believe. Like I said, a lot of where I am now is due to listening to Free Talk Live. You changed my mind on some very important issues years ago.
To random people tuning in on the radio.
I was kind of stuck in the left-right paradigm. I heard your show by chance on a Saturday night. From there, I went on joined the Free State Project and become an amplifier. So, I mean, that's really the reason why I amp is because I know that if it wasn't for you guys being on as many stations as you are, I never would have found the ideas of liberty.
Your amp will directly change more lives by getting Free Talk Live in front of people looking for talk radio online and on the air. You can help by joining the AMP program for just $5 a month at amp.freetalklive.com and getting perks. That's amp.freetalklive.com.
Did you know that FreeAid is a mutual aid, educational, and networking organization? At FreeAid, we support volunteers who provide first aid. We do outreach to the public about health and safety, and we bring together medically skilled freedom lovers. FreeAid is made possible by your generous support. Donors can receive great gifts like first aid kits, t-shirts, silver dime cards, and hoodies. The FreeAid Silver Dime Card Project is sponsored in part by Roberts & Roberts Brokerage, Freedom's Phoenix, and Don't Tread on Meme. Visit fr33aid.com.
Free Talk Live has partnered with Amazon, the largest internet retailer. Imagine a department store category, and Amazon has it. Books, electronics, office products, furniture, jewelry, automotive, toys, clothing, sporting goods, and dozens of other categories. categories. Now you can shop and support Free Talk Live by entering Amazon through our website. Go to shop.freetalklive.com and Amazon will send us a portion of your purchase. You're going to do the shopping anyway, so remember to enter through our site at shop.freetalklive.com. That's shop.freetalklive.com. Are you looking for an excuse to come check out New Hampshire this fall? You're invited to Keenvention. Keenvention is your chance to meet dozens of key liberty activists from across the Shire. You can explore the beautiful little city of Keene, discuss various forms of activism with seasoned veterans, do some Robin Hooding, and learn about making the move. Keenvention received rave reviews last year. If you missed it, visit keenvention.info for full video coverage of every speaker and panel. This year's keynote speeches and panels will be announced via the Keenvention blog and Facebook, so stay tuned there for the latest. Join old and new friends and neighbors in Keene for Keenvention this October 30th through November 1st. Tickets are available now at a special early bird price of just $50 via credit card or Bitcoin. That $50 price only lasts through the end of June, so don't delay. Reserve your tickets now at keenvention.info. Visit keenvention.info for more and look for our page and event on Facebook. That's keenvention.info.
You can interact with other LRN listeners in our message board at forum.lrn.fm. That's forum.lrn.fm.
It's Free Talk Live. You're invited here to dial in toll-free. Share whatever is on your mind here at 855-450-FREE. That's 855-450-3733. And these days, we use battery power on so many devices, it can be hard to keep track. Well, there's a new device that will help you keep your battery-powered devices up and running. It's called the Pocket Power Plus, and it's a source of backup power that's so small you can put it in your pocket or carry it in your purse or your glove box or maybe your briefcase. You're going to want to have this thing with you wherever you are because, well, it's going to help you out. When your smartphone's dead halfway through the day, the Pocket Power Plus can help you there. It's a breakthrough in portable power technology, and it's actually able to charge your laptop as well. In addition, it can deliver an enormous supply of on-demand power, including it can actually jumpstart a car in some circumstances. In fact, they give you a full accessory pack that has most of the adapters that you'll need, including those jumper cables. So go get your Pocket Power Plus for half price by visiting PocketPowerPlus9.com. That's PocketPowerPlus9.com. Use coupon code FTL and you'll save even more on the Pocket Power Plus at PocketPowerPlus9.com. So we're talking about Tragedy of the Commons. And Wanksy, an artist in Manchester, England,
Bury, Greater Manchester,
has gone around into different parts of the city, or at least certain parts of the city, and has painted penises over top of some of the potholes that were there. And his intention was, and it worked, apparently, although city officials are denying that he was the reason for it, his intention was to get the potholes filled. Because apparently people complaining didn't do the job. But once people complained about the penises, then that got the crews out there with the patching kits. And they went and they, you know, put new gravel or tar or whatever the heck it is that you put into a pothole to fill it up. And they did that. And so I guess Wanksy is proud of what he's done here. But the city officials are saying that he's a bad man because he's committed vandalism in this case. Now, I think there's a better argument that he vandalized the streets than, say, the people who've been arrested and prosecuted because they've painted other things on the streets. I don't know if you've, Derek J., if you've heard about the stories where, let's say, somebody feels like there needs to be a crosswalk added somewhere. They'll go out on their own volition and then add the crosswalk to the street, which is
great. Good on him. Take initiative.
I think so. I think that's great. And the city government, of course, doesn't think so because it makes them look bad.
Yeah, wait a minute. You need us. You need us to do that stuff.
Right. Only we can lay paint down on tar.
You can't take initiative.
So it makes them look bad. It makes them look impotent. It makes them look like, you know, that they're
like
slow.
Maybe we don't need them.
Yeah, exactly. And they don't want that. That's the last thing that they want is to be seen as unnecessary. So they come after these people with criminal charges.
Oh, yeah.
And it's sick.
Nothing will teach you how necessary you are like a good beating.
So, you know, I guess I'm curious to know if anybody out there, you know, how do you feel about this? I mean, did Wanksy cross a line by painting, using paint as opposed to chalk? Would it have been less offensive if it were chalk?
Because it wouldn't have worked because the next rain that comes, yeah. no one's going to. It's just, it had to be paint.
Yeah, I think so. And I don't think that it was wrong necessarily. I think that it's an interesting tactic. It certainly accomplished the goal that he set out to accomplish. And hey, it's tragedy of the commons. Nobody owns the streets. The government, I don't see, this is something I
yeah,
disagree
but that's
with
a
you
bad
on,
argument.
Derek J.
Yeah. Okay,
well,
go on.
What's a bad argument? Well, what's bad about it?
Because, okay, I get that you're right. Okay.
You're
but
right,
do you
but
see
it's a
what,
bad argument.
Do you see what the consequences would be? You do, because you know what tragedy of the commons results in.
It can result in a mess. That's certainly true.
Yes.
But there are also people who care about the commons, right? So
no.
Yeah, there are. If look, all you have to do is go to the Schwelet Park here in Keene, and if you look around, you'll notice that there are signs that indicate that certain portions of the park have been donated by private organizations and individuals, and that
That's
there's a
true.
Volunteer group
yeah.
that I believe there is a volunteer group who takes care of that park, that they go and they plant flowers. You know, every spring they go out there and they take care of the park.
And you say, despite this, it is still a commons, even though there are these independent groups.
Well, they
know,
don't
taking
own it.
Charge of it.
It's right. still a city park,
right?
So,
I see.
Yeah, I mean, it's actually. I guess technically, the city would claim that it's not a commons, that it's a park.
But it's not having a tragedy of the commons situation, thanks to these like private individuals. Is that your point?
Yeah, because there are people who are tending to it who care about it. They've sort of adopted the park, if you will. Now, there is still, I think, some level of city care going into that park. I don't know what the difference is between how many hours are put in by city employees versus volunteers. But nonetheless,
I don't know. I like people taking initiative, but I would like to see ownership as well. Like,
me too.
I think it would be cooler if the people were like, we'd like to buy this park from
you.
I
agree.
You know, so that's I guess that's the tack I would want to take is I don't like to treat government property as if I have any claim to it, because I don't claim, like, once a robber steals, you use the analogy of a robber stealing your money and then using it to pave roads. Well, like, once a robber steals something from me, say he takes my guitar, I don't go and treat that guitar as if it's mine now. Like,
why
it's
not?
Because it's his now. That's
no,
how
it's not.
Stealing works.
No.
Ownership
no,
changes.
No. You do not legitimately own something that has been stolen. That the thief does not own what has legitimately been.
No, but I can't take it back.
Yes, you can. And you have the right to take it back. Now, where it gets murky is when that guitar is given to someone else. When the guitar
yeah,
is
but
taken
the,
to a pawn
what about when
shop?
The guitar is sold and turned into a road? I can't take it back. I can't just destroy the road and be like, well, you took my guitar, and now I'm going to destroy your road. I mean, you see how, like...
Now, okay, we're getting... Hold on. I don't want to get lost in the weeds there. So, first of all, the government's not going to take your guitar to pay for the roads.
Okay.
They're going to take money to pay for the
right,
roads, which
right.
means that you have a claim over that road. If they used your money on that road, then you have a claim and you have the right to, in my opinion, use that road. But to go back to your point about the stolen person, the thief, and
yes.
your right as the owner, there was a situation where my bike was stolen right off the front porch of this very LRN.FM studio. This was probably 5 years ago now that this happened. It was actually during the 420 celebrations that were going on. I think it was 2009 when that happened, so it might have been 6 years. Anyway...
Private criminals or
yes,
government criminals?
By private criminals
okay.
who stole the bike, and I didn't have any kind of... there's a security system here now, but at the time that didn't exist. And so I didn't know where that bike was, but I do know that Keene's a small place, and I figured I might possibly see that bike if I was out and about. So if I went downtown and just sort of walked around for a while, then I might actually encounter that bike. And sure enough...
Wow.
When I went down for a 420 celebration, I walked down... to the 420. As I'm walking to the 420, this is the same day as the bike got stolen. I'm walking down to the 420. Two guys, two young men, probably no older than 18, walked by me on one of the main drags in Keene on Court Street, walked by me with a bike that looked almost identical to my bike. Now, Maybe it wasn't my bike. Maybe it was just the same model number. You know, certainly it's certainly
that
possible.
Happens.
That, right. Yeah. It's possible that other people in town had purchased this bike. I bought it from a, you know, an independent bike store in Keene. So there's, it wouldn't be unbelievable that someone else could have the same bike.
Sure.
And so, you know, I'm not just going to confront them and demand, you know, to prove that it's
hey,
a bike.
Hey, that's mine.
Right.
Yeah.
So,
okay. So you know, what'd you do?
I'm being cautious, right? So I kept an eye on them because we walked in. We were walking in different directions. So as I got to the end of the street, I turned around and watched them to see where they were going.
Okay.
And they went down one street in particular that happens to lead to the community kitchen, where a lot of you know, poor people in the area will go to get a free meal.
Oh, so did they park their bike out front?
They did park the bike out front of the community kitchen. So I went to 420, and I, you know, took a little while and enjoyed the 420 celebration. And then after that, I walked over to the community kitchen, and that very same bike was parked in front of the community kitchen. So I wanted to make sure it was my bike. I wanted to verify. I did not want to take somebody else's bike, obviously.
Right.
So I wanted to make sure that it was my bike. And so I went up to the bike, and lo and behold, it still had the little lock thing on it because I hang the lock on. The reason why they were able to steal the bike was because it wasn't locked up, right? So the lock was just sort of hanging from the bike, and it was still locked. So I went, put in my passcode into the lock. It opened the lock.
There you go.
And as far as I was concerned, that was good enough for me. The odds that it was the same model bike with the exact same lock, with the exact same lock code, seemed pretty improbable. So I went ahead and repossessed the bike at that point.
That seems legit.
Yeah, because it was still my bike. 855-450-FREE. It's Free Talk Live.
Are you searching for your soulmate? Someone you can trust who will never betray you or cooperate with the NSA? Stop searching. With EasyDNS, you found a keeper. EasyDNS does it all. Domain names, web hosting, and managed WordPress hosting. EasyDNS stands up for your internet freedom, and with servers in Canada, they do not cooperate with the NSA. Go to EasyDNS.com. You'll love their services or get a full refund. They guarantee it. And they accept Bitcoin. That's EasyDNS.com.
New Hampshire is under quarantine as walking corpses devour the flesh of the living. Max is 11 years old and surviving alone. Slow-moving and non-thinking, the dead swarm his home. Now he must apply his Porcupine Freedom Scouts training to improvise his escape. Look for Survivor Max on Facebook, read reviews on Amazon, or read Chapter 1 at SurvivorMax.com.
By now, you may have heard a bit about Bitcoins, but did you know Bitcoins are now over an $8.5 billion market? And did you know that over 65,000 businesses now accept Bitcoins? Listen, if you're already earning Bitcoins or trying to make money in the Bitcoin market, you've got to know BidBit.co. Why? Because BidBit.co is where you can easily receive Bitcoins by selling and auctioning off your own personal items or promote business products and services for Bitcoins. You heard right. Whether personal or business, you can now buy, sell, and auction your product and services quickly, easily, and securely for Bitcoin at BidBit.co, the first and only marketplace website to offer BidBit escrow, a proprietary technology which gives buyers and sellers security and peace of mind because all transactions are protected. Start today. It's free to join, free to post, free to auction, and free to bid at BidBit.co. Buy, sell, bid, or auction everything Bitcoin. That's www.bidbit.co. BidBit.co.
Cato University is the Cato Institute's premier educational event of the year. It's being held this year from July the 26th to the 31st at the Cato Institute's state-of-the-art headquarters in Washington, D.C. This annual program brings together outstanding faculty and participants from across the country and often from around the globe, with everyone sharing a commitment to liberty and learning. Cato University is a genuine community, and you can freely share viewpoints, concerns, ideas, questions, and more in an atmosphere of friendship and personal respect. It's a one-of-a-kind program for people who don't stop thinking after they got out of school. It's for people who don't want politicians or bureaucrats or officials to do their thinking for them. It's for people who value liberty. You'll learn, you'll be inspired, you'll make new friends, you'll meet great people from around the world. All of the details are spelled out at the Cato website, cato.org, and they hope to see you there this summer, July the 26th through the 31st in Washington, D.C. Again, details are at cato.org.
The three most important things you can do for Free Talk Live are, one, share one episode a week on Facebook or in some other social networking site. Two, Buy the things you buy online through shop.freetalklive.com. 3. Give $5 a month to the AMP program. It's my firm belief that Free Talk Live's AMP program is the best use of your charitable dollar among liberty-oriented organizations. Support all the organizations you love. But make sure you give $5 a month to AMP at amp.freetalklive.com. This is Mark of Free Talk Live. We've been witnessing a meltdown of the economic engine that powers our country. With a printing press tethered to Washington bureaucrats and New York central bankers, how can we trust paper money? For years, I've been buying gold and silver from Midas Resources, and you should too. Call 877-357-9938 for a free book titled 10 Reasons to Own Gold, or go to gold.freetalklive.com. Again, 877-357-9938. 877-357-9938.
If you enjoy LRN.FM, please contribute to your favorite shows via their websites and become an amplifier at amp.lrn.fm. That's amp.lrn.fm.
Free Talk Live. Toll-free numbers, 855-450-FREE. That's 855-450-3733. Tragedy of the Commons is the topic on the table at the moment. But, of course, you can bring up anything that you want. And if you want to support Free Talk Live, one way to do it is by shopping with us. You go to shop.freetalklive.com. Enter Amazon through the links you'll find there. There's also actually a link to Walmart. But enter either one of those, and Free Talk Live will get a cut of your purchase. Amazon's better, I think, because we probably get a little bit of a larger cut from Amazon, and you can get almost anything you need from Amazon, including groceries over at Amazon now. Huh. So, yeah, I mean, I don't think they're selling like fresh fruit or anything, but stuff that you could put on a shelf, that those kind of in a pantry.
Yeah,
those kind of groceries are available. So, once again, go to shop.freetalklive.com as we continue. Ian and Derek J in the studio here tonight. Oh, and your movie, by the way, Derek J, is also available at both Amazon and Walmart. So
that's true.
Yep. So if people have yet to see Victimless Crime Spree, you can of course watch it for free online at victimlesscrimespree.com, but you can also order it through our Amazon link over at shop.freetalklive.com. We're talking about the tragedy of the commons. Do you have a right to use this government property? I say yes, because they stole your money and they used that on whatever, you know, parks or roads or sidewalks. And you said, Derek J, that you try to stay off of these things.
Yeah.
And I don't know how hard you're trying, because you can't really avoid them, right? Like, if you want to go outside of your home, you pretty much have to go via the roads or the sidewalks.
Yes, that's true.
So, in what way are you trying hard to stay off of these things?
I don't know. I try and follow the rules now, right? Like, I have a car that I haven't been driving because it's not registered.
Right.
And that, it frustrates me in one way, because it's like, there's no point in me not driving this car except for the fact that I'm afraid of what would happen if
you could get
bad
kidnapped.
Things to me. Yeah.
They could steal your car at the very least.
So here's what my new strategy is. Like, I'm complying with what I can here. With like, okay, you want me to register my car before I use your roads? All right, fine. They're your roads. But I'm going to have a place of my own where I can have freedom, where you're not allowed. Okay? So if they can
Where's
have
that?
Property, I don't know, but I'm making it. If they can have property, I can have property. We can both coexist and be respectful of each other's rules. They want me to follow a couple
of
rules.
They're not
going to
respect your rules.
Well, I am having
You're
the moral,
living in a fantasy
I'm
land.
Having the moral high ground here of being like, look, you can go and violate my property rights, but I'm going to respect property rights and set the example here.
Okay, now that's something. I can definitely respect that, but I don't think they have a right to property, and that's where I think what you're saying breaks down. I mean, I like the idea of trying to be better than them, no doubt about it, and setting your goals and your standards higher. I'm with you there. Don't use violence. That's their tool. So I'm on board that far.
Yeah.
But they don't have a legitimate right to anything they have, which is why I don't have a problem with things like painting a penis on a road, because it's not their property, nor is it anyone else's, so who cares? And further, you know, it wouldn't bother me if somebody put, I've always talked about, you know, sort of monkey wrenching with the government property. Like, if the Bearcat all of a sudden had all of the air let out of its tires, that wouldn't bother me either. If somebody put epoxy in the front door locks of the police station, wouldn't bother me at all. I mean, those are all acts of vandalism.
I don't like the destruction, though. Wait, isn't there a better way, really, like, than destroying stuff? I don't want the air to be let out of the tires. I want them to abandon the property itself and or sell it. I mean, sell it to someone who can use it. Don't destroy stuff.
Well, in that case, that's Derek, you should run for city council.
Yeah, that'd be fun. Then give everything away, start selling the properties. I mean, that would be ideal. That's what I really want to see. I think that's a peaceful solution that makes sense.
I agree.
It's like the government claims to own this stuff. If you want them not to own it, you don't destroy it. You let them sell it.
Yeah, but they aren't going to sell it. They have no interest in doing anything of the sort. The city council voted overwhelmingly for this Bearcat. For those that don't know, the Bearcat is a ballistic engineered
armored
attack truck.
Counter attack truck.
Yeah. It's a tank. You can mount a 50 cal to the top. It's got
gun
ports.
It's not a tank. It has wheels, Ian. Tanks don't have wheels.
The city council called it a tank. Two of the city councilors acknowledged.
We're gonna have our own tank.
Yeah, that's what they said during one of their meetings. And so the city council wants this thing. They want to appease the police. There's nobody who's proposed, except for maybe one city councilor. The majority of them are certainly not interested in getting rid of this thing. And I don't think you're seriously going to run for city council, but I think you should because I think it'd be fun. You should run on that platform. Get rid of the Bearcat.
Yeah. All right.
End the parking department. End the parking department. Get rid of the Bearcat.
Yeah, what if I just... No, just the one issue. Single issue candidates.
Okay.
They have the best chance, don't they? Where, you know, you can really capture attention for like half a second when you're campaigning.
I think so. And there's
also... be like, Bearcat.
There's also the argument that the Bearcat is less popular than the parking department. So that's probably like a key
issue.
Yeah,
people
you could
run defend
on.
The parking. It's going to muddy the issues. I just want to keep it to Bearcat. If I could sell the Bearcat... That would be a huge victory. I mean,
you know,
if one person could get elected to city council and somehow do that, I don't even think they have the power to, though.
Here's the problem with the idea of selling the Bearcat is that there may be a provision in the agreement with the federal government that they can't sell it. But I bet you could give it back. So would you support that? Like if...
Yeah, give it back.
Right. If the agreement prohibited selling the Bearcat, then... driving it back down to Lenco and dropping it off there and giving them the keys. Here you go. We don't want it anymore. Would that be acceptable?
Yeah, but I wouldn't want to drive it. I wouldn't want to make the chief of police drive it, and then he has to walk home.
Oh, that would be awesome. Unfortunately, by the time the election happens, that same chief of police may not be the chief of police anymore.
Well, I'll make him do it anyway.
The old guy.
Oh. Bring him back.
If you want your pension, you got to go for a walk, buddy.
Yeah.
So let's go to your calls and thoughts. We do have Jerry on the line in St. George. Jerry, you're on Free Talk Live.
Yeah, so I'm a little confused. You said the roads aren't theirs. I'm assuming you're referring to the government?
That's correct. The government acts like they own things, but they don't, in my opinion, legitimately own anything because everything they own was garnered through the threat of violence and stealing.
Oh, okay. I see what you're saying. So you're saying because they... didn't go about it the right way to possess it, they don't possess it? I mean, it's still there.
Oh, no, they possess it. Like, they will do things to you. They will hurt you if you mess with the things that they consider to be theirs. But legitimately, they don't have any control. I mean, to my mind, they don't have any legitimate ownership over it.
Well, they do. And the reason they do is because the government, as you're referring to, is the people. The problem
no, it's
is
not.
Well, the problem is the people don't care about what the government is anymore, and the people let a very few run the rest of them. So the idea of what we have in this country as a government is the people is the government is kind of a, I don't want to say fantasy, but it's just,
it's ridiculous. It's the idea that the government is the people is just an absurd thing that the government people say. The supporters of government love that particular line because it sort of pawns off responsibility for what the government people do. Like, oh, well, we're you. We're just you enforcing on yourself or something like that.
Yeah, but you can't – you don't want – I guess you could, but you don't want just everybody doing whatever the heck they want whenever they want, writing penises all over everything.
Well, in that case, you should have private property.
I mean, you can't have anarchy.
Well,
you could have anarchy, but I don't want anarchy.
Well, look, I'm not arguing for anarchy here. I'm arguing for private property. wherein if you have private property and people believe in the idea of private property and respect private property, then a private property owner can decide what should be allowed and what shouldn't be allowed.
Well, and I think we used to have in this country private property, but we're getting away from that because people, the voters, the government, is complacent. They're letting a few bully the rest. And personally, I think a lot of it's through education and lawmaking and attorneys. You know, they've educated themselves to the point of circumventing everybody, and they're doing that with laws that the people are just like, yeah, sure, that sounds good at first, and then it gets worse and worse, and it snowballs, and here we are, you know.
Yeah, and then it's but hard it's, to
I
really
think
undo
you're
that.
Right, though. It's going to get so bad. It's getting to the point now where it's getting so bad that I do believe the people will wake up and take it back. So the people will take the government back.
How are they going to do that, though?
What does that look like?
Well, we do have the right to own weapons in this country. That hasn't gone. That'll be the very last right they take from us.
Are you suggesting that people should storm City Hall with weapons? I mean, what are you getting at there?
No, I'm saying they should hang on to their weapons because when it comes down to it, Japan, from what I understand, didn't invade this country in World War II because they said that they knew every household, for the most part, had a gun.
Yeah, that much is true.
That'd be a tough fight.
Jerry, thanks for the call, man.
Germany would have held on.
I agree with you on that point. Thank you for the call tonight. I appreciate hearing from you. We'll continue with your calls and thoughts here at 855-450-FREE. And that's one of the reasons why the government doesn't just roll right in with tanks. There are people with guns, and they know it. It's Free Talk Live.
Growth can be an intimidating six-letter word, especially when the guys upstairs want 7% of it. That's why you need one eight-letter word, G-R-A-I-N-G-E-R, Granger. The G is for growth. From industry specialists to over a million products across almost every category, Grainger has the resources to help us grow. Now, can you guess what my favorite four-letter word is? W-O-R-K. Let's get back to it. Get it? Got it? Good. Call, click Grainger.com, or stop by. Grainger, for the ones who get it done.
Geico Motorcycle presents Reflections from the Road.
Let me tell you, the road is a much more relaxing place since I switched to Geico Motorcycle Insurance and started saving money. With that taken care of, now I can think about deep, important things. Like how come it's a pair of pants when there's only one of them? A real brain teaser. But hey, at least saving money with Geico Motorcycle is as easy as pie. What does that mean, anyway?
Geico Motorcycle Insurance. See how much you could save.
Radio is the most personal of mediums. I exist right now in your head. If you listen to Free Talk Live regularly, you know me. Free Talk Live is on more than 160 radio stations around the U.S. and has been downloaded on every continent around the world. Hundreds of thousands of listeners with ad packages from $600 a month to $6,000 a month. Imagine what we can do for your business, project, website, or idea. Email me, Mark, at freetalklive.com.
You can listen to Free Talk Live on the radio, podcast, satellite, webcam, and our live streams. But did you know you can listen to Free Talk Live from any phone, anywhere? Add this number to your phone, 213-493-0308. It's a long-distance call, so make sure you're familiar with your phone's calling plan. The listen lines are airing the latest episode of Free Talk Live 24 hours a day, including our live shows. Call 213-493-0308. That's 213-493-0308.
You're listening to the live edition of Free Talk Live. Hour number three is next after the news here on the Liberty Radio Network at LRN.FM.
From Keene in the Shire, the Liberty Media capital of the world, this is Daryl W. Perry, host of FPP Radio News for Monday, April 27th, 2015. Silver is trading at $15.87 per ounce. Gold is valued at $1,187 per ounce. And according to BitcoinAverage.com, the average price of Bitcoin is $219. Antiwar.com reports for the Senate Republican majority to get enough votes for a series of anti-Iran amendments to an upcoming bill, which itself aims to block the Iran nuclear deal, they're going to need support from a number of Democrats. The strategy right now among Republican leaders is to try to coax the Democrats on board by adding a number of measures about Israel in the hopes that fear of angering the powerful Israeli lobby will oblige them to support the legislation. Dozens of amendments are expected, with many focusing on demands calls for Iran to publicly endorse Israel and for the administration to affirm that Iran is sufficiently pro-Israel to ease sanctions on them. There's an interesting split here, however, as AIPAC, one of the most powerful groups in this lobby, is openly opposing these efforts to make the bill more explicitly about Israel. It's unsurprising AIPAC should feel this way. After all, Israel and its lobbyists have been working tooth and nail to kill a diplomatic settlement with Iran, but that doesn't mean they want to have their names splattered all over the bill that does it. The hope among Senate hawks is that killing the deal is a prelude to a big war, and the last thing AIPAC needs is for Israel to be so directly responsible for that. For over 35 years, Robertson Roberts has been a trusted source for buying and selling your investment-grade precious metals. They also take Bitcoin for precious metal purchases and permanently removed the minimum purchase order for all orders paid in the digital currency. Call Robertson Roberts today for knowledgeable advice on investing and a forward-thinking approach to new technologies. 850-478-5270 or online at rrbi.co. UPI reports a Russian court jailed and fined a group of women who filmed themselves twerking in front of a World War II memorial on the country's Black Sea coast. Prosecutors sentenced Margarita Radichskaya to 15 days in jail for petty hooliganism, along with two other women who received 10-day sentences. Two additional women were fined, while the parents of a sixth dancer, who is under the age of 18, face fines and monitoring over charges of failing to perform parental duties for raising minors. The sixth can be seen in a YouTube video that was published on Friday performing a synchronized dance that at times utilizes twerking, a form of dance involving low squatting and hip thrust. A large memorial marking a 1943 battle in which the Soviet Army captured the area from Nazi forces looms in the background. The women said they filmed the video as a promotion for a dance class at a local school. Prosecutors said the erotic and sexual twerk dance was disrespectful to those who died in the conflict. The incident also follows a national scandal over a YouTube video of girls from a dance school twerking while dressed in striped leotards, miniskirts, and stockings. The video, which has been viewed over 23 million times, resulted in the cancellation of the twerking classes at the school and an investigation by Russian authorities as to whether a debauched action took place. FPP Radio News is brought to you by Coinbase. Coinbase is a simple and secure online Bitcoin wallet for sending, receiving, and storing Bitcoin. Coinbase also allows you to buy and sell Bitcoin using a bank account or use their tools to accept Bitcoin as a merchant. Coinbase has more than 1 million consumer wallets and is trusted by over 25,000 merchants, including Overstock.com, Khan Academy, Reddit, and of course, FPP. Get started at coinbase.fppradio.com. Reuters reports the U.S. Supreme Court is set to hear arguments this week on whether a drug used in Oklahoma's lethal injection mix should be banned in a case that comes as the shortage of execution chemicals has sent some states scrambling for alternatives. The main question before the nine justices in the case brought by three death row inmates that will be heard on Wednesday is whether the use of the sedative midazolam violates constitutional protections against cruel and unusual punishment. The case does not address the constitutionality of the death penalty in general, but brings fresh attention to the debate over whether executions should continue in the United States. Executions in Oklahoma came under great scrutiny after the flawed lethal injection a year ago of convicted murderer Clayton Lockett, who received midazolam and was seen twisting on the death chamber gurney after medical staff improperly placed the IV line. This has been FPP Radio News, online at fppradio.com.
A harrowing situation on Broad Street came to its conclusion Thursday night as a group of hostages were freed from local comedy club The Laugh Up Lounge after a tense 7-minute stand-up set.
Every once in a while, he'd grab his notebook, and I'd think maybe this is it. Maybe he's gonna let us go, but he just kept talking.
Additionally, The Onion recovered this video footage from the cell phone of one of the many captives.
Please, if someone sees this, help us. Please help.
Yeah, micromanagement.
You guys are totally going to wang it out.
Oh, my God. Oh, my God, no.
Cool.
I'm not a religious person, but at one point I said the Lord's Prayer, and it actually had a calming effect. Like, Jesus was standing next to me and said, you're going to get through this.
I mean, sometimes you're just in the wrong place at the wrong time. You know, don't take life for granted, because you just never know when something like this could happen. So.
This is the Onion News Network.
Free Talk Live. Join us here toll free and bring up whatever you want to talk about. That is the point of the program. With you in the studio tonight, you've got Ian
and Derek J.
And don't forget to visit Derek J over at flamingfreedom.com to check out his show. It's a once a week, what do you call it? Like a gay cast? Like what's a good short short name for that?
It's for gay anarchists.
Oh yeah, I love that term. That's so cool. Who coined that term?
Me. If you find yourself queer and an anarchist, then you might enjoy Flaming Freedom, even if you're just curious.
I'm not queer, maybe a little, but
I think you're queer.
But I loved it. I love that show. It's one of my favorites. I think it's a lot of fun to listen to.
Thank you. It's even more fun to watch.
Yeah, it is a little voyeuristic as well. Like it's like you're looking into the sex lives of all of the hosts, although some more open about it than others. The earlier episodes were pretty funny where you were the most open about all things sexual.
They're opening up though.
Are they? Okay.
Yeah, they're getting there. Dale is turning around.
Yeah, I heard him talking about like going on a date so he could remember why he doesn't date or something like that.
At the beginning, see, he swore off dating altogether and was just D&D and dungeons and I guess that's that sort of thing.
Mm-hmm.
Not into the sex anymore, but now he's coming around. It's important. It's about health.
Let's go to your calls and thoughts. You can bring up anything. Coming up, the Supreme Court with a decent ruling about drug dogs and waiting for them on the side of the road. But first, let's talk to Glenn in Philly. Glenn, you're on Free Talk Live with Ian and Derek J.
Good evening, gentlemen. Well, if you're not queer, you're at least fairly odd.
Thanks, Glenn.
I get the gist of your stance on public property, but the only thing I can think of that's more problematic than public property is private property.
Why is that?
Because it begs the question of who is to be the arbiter of contradictory claims on property. And, you know, so like if you're, and I'm in the suburbs of Philadelphia, right? So if you're a Lenni Lenape Indian, you know, living on the shores of the Delaware River in the 1700s, and this funny-looking guy comes along, you know, with a strangely dressed fellow with a wig named William Penn, who, you know, meets you and is pleasant and polite and thanks you for taking care of his sylvan setting, his woods, his Pennsylvania, granted to him by the king across the Atlantic, who thought it was his private property. And all the time, the Indians living on it didn't, you know, the indigenous peoples, actually, living there, were completely unaware of the existence of this king or his country or the son of his friend Penn, to whom this king granted your land. This is a private property disagreement. And how are these to be arbitrated?
Yeah, that's an excellent question. I think you bring up a good concern, and obviously in that case, it would seem that the king was certainly in the wrong, given that those people had homesteaded, you know, the Native Americans had homesteaded that land, and, you know, one of the viewpoints on private property that I like to subscribe to is that homesteading is a legitimate way to claim unclaimed land. What were they going to do? Go to the king's courts to try to arbitrate that? I think you bring up a good example, but of course we're not in the 17th or 18th century.
No, that's just an example.
Yeah,
this is just an example.
But before you go on, you're also giving an example of like a culture clash as well between two different groups of people who don't necessarily hold the same values. The Indians in that case did not really have the same understanding of private property likely as the people who had come in there. Whereas today, I'd like to answer your question a little bit further here, if you don't mind. Whereas today, if we were to shift from no public property to all private property, then you could have arbitrators who would be set to decide these things, professionals who would be able to make a decision in a case.
Oh, I see. Okay, arbitrators. What if the authority of the arbitrator is not acknowledged by the person? Like, these arbitrators are individuals designated by groups, which sounds an awful lot like governance to me.
Well, the difference between an arbitrator and a government court is that the arbitrator is selected by the parties involved in the dispute by consent, Whereas a government court usually is forced upon the parties without consent.
Yeah, this already happens with car insurance. I mean, you have a different car insurance than the person who hit you, and they can still work it out, and you guys normally don't even have to talk.
But, okay, so the individual at the private party who claims that he owns, you know, the 80 acres of land, and his family's been farming this ground for 200 years, and he owns Walton's Mountain and all the forests surrounding down to such and such a creek and such a gully over there. And he's just adamant that, no, I don't care about your arbitrator. I don't accept his authority. This is our land, and that's just the way it is. I don't acknowledge your authority.
So then what comes into play is a possible reputation system. And there's a great book called The Market for Liberty that I recommend. They go into detail on arbitration and how it could possibly work. Now, obviously, we can't predict exactly how things would work in a system without a coercive state, but there's some good ideas out there, and, you know, I'll throw this one out there. So, you know, if you have a reputation system, then what you don't want to do is have your reputation ruined by the fact that you won't go to arbitration. If somebody is making a claim and you know, you've been told, hey, there's this case and we'd like to have you, you know, come represent yourself at this case, and then you say, well, the hell with you, I don't believe in your system, and I own all this land, then your reputation would be damaged by the fact that you would not come to defend yourself, and then in theory other people would not want to deal with you because you are untrustworthy.
Oh, and so that's just like psych warfare instead of legal warfare or physical warfare. That's social psychological manipulation. Let's say if two different guys, you know, live far away from each other, have never met yet, each considers their overlapping, you know, area of land on to be theirs.
And they've never met? How is that possible that they have overlapping land that they both think is theirs and they've never met?
Because people sometimes have large swaths of land and or somewhat provincial in their travels. I mean, historically, you know, people didn't travel very far from their homes. They might consider themselves to be owners of swaths of land and never even, you know, venture out to them the perimeter.
All right, let's go on with your example. Yeah. Go ahead.
Okay. So, but this, and this question of homesteading. So. In your mind, private property ownership is achieved through homesteading.
Not always. You can trade. You can buy and sell property. I was giving you an example as to, you know, that homesteading is a classical way of obtaining property for oneself that was previously unowned. Now, homesteading owned property is a whole other discussion to have. But no, one legitimate way to acquire property would be to purchase it or to trade for it or to, you know, or to possibly, you know, buy it from somebody else. Right.
Like, I guess my contention is that humans have always been, you know, had the potential to be selfish or to esteem things to be theirs, and humans have always fought, you know, over things.
You fight over things?
I think humans have always fought and killed. I mean,
right, which is why
you? I don't believe that. I don't think that is the case, because I don't see that in my life.
No,
do you?
I don't fight because I'm within a given. Yeah. I'm within.
Most people are very peaceful, and they're willing to trade for the things that they want. Glenn, thanks for the call tonight. I appreciate hearing from you. The toll-free number is 855-450-FREE. He basically suggested that the reputation system was some sort of psychological warfare. I would have liked to have talked a little bit further about that. Seems like a ridiculous statement. It's not warfare.
It's not manipulating someone either to give a report on how they're doing. I mean, that happens on Yelp reviews. The businesses ask for reviews.
Right.
It's not like they feel like they're being manipulated by their customers
This is feedback. This is, you know, a classic way of the market mechanism of giving feedback to a seller or a buyer. And, you know, eBay, of course, used to be good at this until they removed... What did they remove? They removed the buyer, leaving feedback for buyers, right? You can't leave feedback for buyers anymore on eBay.
Huh.
Isn't that right?
I didn't know that. No.
I'm surprised. You list items on eBay
all the
time.
I use eBay
right?
all the time. I didn't know that. No, I think that is. I think you can still list feedback for
buyers.
I don't
think you can. I think only the buyer can list feedback for a seller on eBay. It used to be both ways, but it's not anymore, and I don't know why they made that change. But yeah, reputation is a way to socially pressure. It's not warfare. It's just social pressure to pressure people to behave better. And in the case of a private property dispute, if you don't come to the arbitration, then you probably are going to lose it, and you'll also lose your reputation, which could hurt you in a more private world. More coming up. Free Talk Live.
Are you completely free of stress and fatigue? Well, of course not. You aren't alone, though. Now think about how nice it would be to begin relieving some of that stress and fatigue. Let me introduce you to a product that has and is working for me. It's called Youthful Greens. Youthful Greens. It's packed full of nature's nourishing, cleansing, and alkalizing greens, providing a powerful dose of whole food nutrition in each serving. Youthful Greens helps increase overall energy levels and reduce all that fatigue and stress on your body. And right now, when you visit freegreens.net or call 800-333-6923 and order your 1 month supply of Youthful Greens for only $29.95, you get another month's supply for free. That's 2 months of Youthful Greens for the already low price of just $29.95, plus free shipping. That's saving you $45. Visit freegreens.net today or simply call 800-333-6923. And hey, you're welcome.
This is Mark of Free Talk Live. We've been witnessing a meltdown of the economic engine that powers our country. With a printing press tethered to Washington bureaucrats and New York central bankers, how can we trust paper money? For years, I've been buying gold and silver from Midas Resources, and you should too. Call 877-357-9938 for a free book titled 10 Reasons to Own Gold, or go to gold.freetalklive.com. Again, 877-357-9938. 877-357-9938.
Farmers keep livestock lean and healthy with a mineral-rich diet. Then, before market, they cut off minerals, leaving them to crave high-calorie grains. If weight control is this easy, why prescribe surgery for humans? Introducing Youngevity. You could avoid 900 diseases by getting 90 essential nutrients from Youngevity. Check out 90 for Life at tobeyoungagain.com or call 855-79-YOUNG. That's 855-79-YOUNG or tobeyoungagain.com. Youngevity. It's all about saving money, getting healthy, and creating wealth.
It's the Onion Radio News. All seven deadly sins were committed at a church bake sale. This is Doyle Redland reporting. Avarice, sloth, envy, lust, gluttony, pride, and wrath. All seven of the fabled deadly sins were committed on Sunday at the twice annual bake sale at St. Mary's of the Immaculate Conception Church. According to St. Mary's treasurer, Beth Ellen Coyle, church-sponsored events are a notorious breeding ground for these treasonous acts against the Lord God.
This is supposed to be about the glorification of God, not violating His word. Do that and you're no better than that cheap strumpet Melissa Wyckoff with those sinful chocolate cookies of hers.
The seven deadly sins were first outlined in the 5th century by Gregory the Great, who himself was, as indicated by his very name, toying dangerously with the sin of pride. Doyle Redland for the Onion Radio News, online at theonion.com.
This is the Onion News Network.
Did you know that you can listen to and watch Free Talk Live during our live show 7 days a week from 7 to 10 p.m. Eastern via our studio cam at cam.freetalklive.com? Not only that, but you can also chat with other listeners at the same time. Do I need to mention that both the studio cam and chat room are totally free? Outside of Free Talk Live's live hours, you won't see a cam feed, but we'll hear audio from the Liberty Radio Network. So listen, watch, and chat all free at cam.freetalklive.com. That's cam.freetalklive.com.
If there was a place that liberty-minded people had been elected to political positions and were rolling back government, would you move there? If freedom lovers had secured a 20% voting block and can veto most bad bills, would you move? Well, the time has come to sign the pledge at freestateproject.org. These things have happened in New Hampshire, and you can join us and help. freestateproject.org. Sign up now at freestateproject.org.
You can put the Liberty Radio Network on the air in your area. Visit broadcast.lrn.fm to learn how. Broadcast.lrn.fm. See.
This is Free Talk Live. You can dial in toll-free here. Whether you want to talk about property rights, or the idea that government doesn't own anything legitimately. Twerking. We talked about twerking earlier in the show tonight. Dancing is apparently prohibited in Russia and also in New York City. Not that twerking is prohibited, but Dancing is prohibited if you don't have a cabaret license in New York City. So we've covered a lot of ground here tonight. You can share your thoughts on anything you'd like to discuss here. 855-450-FREE is the number. If we get the chance, we'll tell you about the good news coming out of the Supreme Court. And, of course, you can bring up whatever's on your mind. By the way, if you get online at all, you need to protect your privacy. And you cannot expect your privacy to be protected by default. In fact, by default, your internet service provider is probably logging every single website you visit. And maybe keeping those logs for several years. If you got a coffee shop, maybe there's somebody there trying to sniff your Wi-Fi packets out to get your banking password or your credit card information or something like that. You can stop all that from happening by using ProXPN, and you can go and download it for free. So there's really no reason not to try this. Go to proxpn.com/FTL, and that is where you can download their app for Windows, Mac, iOS, Android, and Linux. Pretty much everything you're out there using on your daily basis, whether it's your smartphone or laptop, desktop computer, computer at work, you get ProXPN installed on it, and you're protected from prying and spying. Now, code FTL50 will get you 50% off the price of the annual account, which brings the price down to around $5 a month, and it gets you access to the premium level features like unlimited bandwidth, servers around the world that you can access, you can privately torrent, and get past regionally blocked websites. You do it all with our discount code FTL50 and go to proxpn.com/FTL. It's a risk-free 7-day money-back guarantee. You have nothing to lose but your privacy, so don't delay. Go and get ProXPN. ProXPN.com/FTL. Promo code is FTL50. And by the way, that 50% discount is good for the lifetime of the account. So when you're ready to renew for your second year, you still get the same great deal. ProXPN.com/FTL. Code FTL50. Let's continue with your calls and thoughts. By the way, breaking news out of Maryland. Apparently, the National Guard has been called in with days of continuing protests happening in Baltimore. If we have time, we'll look into a little bit deeper into that.
Isn't it a little late to call the National Guard? Well, it's been like 2 weeks.
Yeah, it's been a week. It's been a solid week, and things went pretty crazy on Saturday.
It's almost 2 weeks. It happened on April 12th is when this man died.
True. No. He died on the 19th. He was arrested on the 12th.
Oh.
So it's been over a week now this point since he perished. Let's go to your calls and thoughts first, though. James is in Kalamazoo. You're on Free Talk Live with Ian and Derek J. Hello, James.
Good evening.
Hey.
I just for those people out there that think that we need the government for roads, to maintain them and do what they will. I'd just like to kind of mirror that with a place I used to live that was so poor that they couldn't afford a paid fire department. The entire fire department was voluntary. Mm-hmm. And when there was a fire, they dropped what they were doing. Everybody understood. And they went and worked for free.
Most fire departments are like that, by the way. Most of them around the United States.
I just think that instinctively people are good, and would see that the road needed work and would voluntarily go work on it.
Yeah, well, also, especially if they owned the roads, if the private property owners actually own the roads in front of their homes, then they would want, in theory, they would want to take good care of it. Now, obviously, there are going to be the outliers who just don't give a flip about the quality of their road.
Oh, who cares about them?
Right. They got a big 4x4 pickup with huge wheels on it, and they don't care how bad their road is in front of their house. But if there's more than one house on the road, odds are good some of the people there are going to care about it.
No, I'll bet you know every pothole on the way back to your house when you're driving, and you would fill any one of those if you had the opportunity.
Yes, absolutely. There was actually a guy up in Grand Rapids a few years ago that actually got arrested for going out and trying to fix the roads.
Oh, wow.
The government was behind on it. He went down to the place where he knew the stuff was to fill in the potholes, and he put it in the back of his truck, and he went and he filled potholes.
I think that's heroic. And in fact, years ago, before I moved here to Keene, New Hampshire, as part of the Free State Project, so this is a decade ago now, there were the earliest movers here. Now, of course, the Free State Project is the idea of moving 20,000 liberty-oriented people all to the same place, to New Hampshire. And Keene is one of the destinations in New Hampshire. It's a smaller city. Population 25,000. Anyway, there were a group of activists led by Russell Canning, who was one of the earliest movers, who went out and filled potholes around town. I don't think they ever arrested him or did anything to him for that. And that was something that years later, I actually met with a guy here in town. He reached out to me, said he wanted to go out for a cup of coffee or something, just to talk about various different things.
Oh.
And this guy actually said that the most memorable thing, his favorite activism that anyone had ever done in Keene was the filling of the potholes. He really remembered that. Like, that was a really meaningful thing because it actually helps people, right? Like, that's...
Yeah,
because
everyone's in their car saying, who's going to fix this? When are they going to fix this? And no one says, I'll fix it.
I love it. Well, I mean, when people do that. Take their own initiative and get out there and get it done.
I mean, everybody should know that, you know, the state is inefficient at spending money. You know, just another example, you know... Downtown here, there are several brick roads that were probably built before the state actually like really took over. And in a lot of the areas, you know, and they stand the test of time. You know, they have to do nothing with these roads. And so they put this product out there that every few years they have to go scrape a layer off and put it back down.
Right.
And that process costs money.
Great points tonight, James. I mean, anything else you want to share?
Nope, I love you guys. I can't wait to be there.
Oh, thank you for the call tonight. I appreciate hearing from you. The toll-free number is 855-450-FREE. I love the idea of the fixing the roads activism. I wish somebody would bring that one back. I would donate to it if they did. But I don't like going out and doing construction work, so I'm not gonna probably not gonna help with it. But I'd put some money towards it.
Yeah, that one's not for me.
Let's go to Brett, listening in Baltimore. Brett, you're on Free Talk Live with Ian and Derek J.
Hey guys, how's it doing? Well,
go ahead, sir.
Yeah, you guys sort of hit on the Baltimore riots a little bit ago and how they're activating the National Guard.
That's right. That's the headline tonight.
Right. I was I actually work in Baltimore, and they shut down the plant down there, and they don't even do that for blizzards, so people are going nuts out here.
Is that the power plant?
What plant?
Oh, it's a machine shop. We make like parts for planes and stuff.
Oh.
They shut it down. They would never normally do that, not even for blizzards.
So this is where you work, is what you're saying. The place where you work has been shut down, and this is the only time that's ever happened since you've worked there.
Well, not ever happened, but it's very rare that it says it's only when something really serious is going on. And a couple of my buddies, they actually know people. A lot of people that work there live in the area, and they're real worried about these riots. Like, I was being seen showing pictures of cars flipped upside down, on fire, doors being robbed and looted, and I was actually driving home, going over the bridge. I could see this huge plume of smoke coming out of Baltimore City.
Wow. If you want to tell us more, hang on. We'll bring it back. You can explain, because you're there, about what's happening, because this is what I was wondering last night. I mean, all we can go on is the reports of the mainstream media. I couldn't find any live streams yesterday, but it looks like things are heating up again tonight in Baltimore. 855-450-FREE. Of course, it was a funeral today for the gentleman who was killed in police custody.
This alert just came in. This special announcement is for business owners and leaders of organizations who've been waiting for the right time to build. General Steel has made it impossible to wait any longer with rock-bottom prices that could save you thousands. That's right, General Steel, America's leader in pre-engineered structures, is offering buildings at prices you will never see again. Don't miss these prices. A 50 by 100 for $35,000. You heard right. That's 5,000 square feet for $35,000. Manufacturers, if you need a larger building, try a 100 by 100 commercial building for $129,000. You can't afford to rent with these prices. Imagine a 70 by 100 foot church building for under $69,000. With the economy improving and interest rates still at historic lows, you can't afford to wait. So call 866-91-STEEL. Lock in your price now. Call 866-91-STEEL. That's 866-917-8335.
What if the key to achieving liberty in your lifetime was to move together with others who think like you? Liberty activists are joining the Free State Project, which is over 70% of the way to its goal of 20,000 participants. And they're already making the move to New Hampshire. The successes are piling up and are proving the Free State Project is a real movement and no longer just a great idea. When you're planning your move, consider Keene. Keene is famous for its civil disobedience and non-cooperation, and there's plenty of political opportunity as well. From demonstrations and vigils to outreach and volunteering, there's a lot going on in Keene. Keene is the Liberty Media capital of the world, with television, talk radio, and more all originating here. Though it's more than just activism, with regular social events each week. See what's happening at freekeene.com and get connected with video, audio, free books, a forum, and activist tools you can download and use in your area at freekeene.com. That's freekeene.com.
This Your Family Today tip is brought to you by Boost Kid Essentials Nutritionally Complete Drink, providing your picky eater with essential nutrition and great taste in one drink. Visit us at kidessentials.com. To make sure your kids eat healthy, follow the 5-a-day plan. Serve 3 servings of vegetables and 2 servings of fruit daily. Remember, a serving could just mean a piece of fruit or a half cup of veggies. If your kids are picky eaters, ask a nutritionist about other sources. For more tips like these, visit us at parenthood.com/yourfamilytoday.
The 3 most important things you can do for Free Talk Live are 1, share 1 episode a week on Facebook or in some other social networking site. 2, buy the things you buy online through shop.freetalklive.com. 3, give $5 a month to the AMP program. You likely buy all kinds of things online. Amazon is the largest online retailer. You can get what you need at the same prices with free Super Saver shipping by going to shop.freetalklive.com. Please do your online shopping at shop.freetalklive.com.
Since time began, tyrants have taken aim at personal liberties. Now there's a movie that aims back.
The government has no more right to tell us what to put in our bodies than they have to take our guns or tell us what books we can read.
6 drug police were eaten by bears while raiding a marijuana farm.
On your knees, you dirty hippies!
Jesus.
On your knees!
What's the problem, officer?
Today, many cops who enforce pot laws do so only because it provides them with cushy jobs, good benefits, and a chance to push people around.
I was an undercover narcotics officer. The drug war is nothing but a farce.
The Second Amendment says you gotta keep you and your gat intact.
Guns and Weed, the Road to Freedom. A film by Michael W. Dean and Nima Vadavi.
DVD available now at gunsandweed.com or on Amazon. That's gunsandweed.com. Makes the perfect gift. Remember, that's gunsandweed.com.
You can connect with the Liberty Radio Network via our Facebook page at facebook.lrn.fm. That's facebook.lrn.fm.
This is Free Talk Live. You may dial in toll-free at 855-450-FREE. The breaking news is the National Guard is being called into Baltimore. The Maryland governor has called them up, and apparently the riots continued today after the funeral for Freddie Gray, who's the guy we talked extensively about last night on this program. He's the guy who died while in police custody after being arrested for no apparent reason. There wasn't a warrant
out. There's still no charges, right? Do we know what
his charges were? Well, he's dead, so certainly not going to be a charge now. But at the time, yeah, I don't know. There was no information was being released by the police department as far as why he was arrested beyond the fact that he ran from
the cops. He looked at us funny.
Right. He looked at a cop and ran. That was it. So, and apparently he's got a rap sheet that includes drug dealing and possession of drugs.
Oh, my.
So, not actually any real crime that I'd seen. Now, look, I haven't looked at his whole rap sheet, so maybe at some point in there is some real crime, but I did see an excerpt of it, and there was somebody that posted on Facebook, like, look, this guy's a criminal, and that shows all these drug-related so-called
crimes. Oh, wow,
crimes.
He had pot once.
Yeah, well, several times. He's got several arrests, but still.
Oh, he had pot more than once?
At a glance.
What a criminal.
Yeah, maybe it was hard drugs. I don't care. You know, it's still his body. He should be able to do what he wants with it. If he wants to sell drugs to somebody, he should be able to.
I feel like I can relate to this guy. When I heard about this story, I saw he's 25. His birthday was 2 months after mine. So we're like very close in age range. Mm-hmm. And I feel similarly when I see a cop, I want to run in the opposite direction too. And
there's, I don't blame you.
That shouldn't be a crime. It shouldn't be reason enough.
I don't
for
think
them
it is a crime.
Pursue me.
And I agree, it should not be probable cause that the person may have committed a crime.
I just don't like them and I want to be away from them.
Let's get right. You're very sensible in that way, Derek J., because these people are, it can be very dangerous. They can be very hazardous to your health.
Yes, he proved the point, right? Like, by being like, I have to run from you because you're a lion and I'm a limpy gazelle and you're going to come and get me. And that's, I don't know. Maybe the Limpy Gazelle has to fake it and just try and blend in a little bit.
Brett, you're back on Free Talk Live, and you're actually in Baltimore. So you've been experiencing what it's been like there over the last week. Tell us more.
That's right, guys. And it's odd because I've heard more information about this Freddie Gray guy from you guys just chit-chatting about it before bringing me back on. And I think that's really sad because now everyone's just talking about the looters and the rioters instead of actually talking about this guy that the police actually killed.
Yeah, isn't he the point?
What was that?
Isn't he the point? Isn't he who we're supposed to be focusing on here? The whole... this guy is dead and it better be for something.
Right, and now it's because it seems like there's outside insiders coming in, because that's just what I've been hearing from talking to people and people on Facebook saying that. And I was just that whole, I was shocked to see like this big plume of smoke coming out of Baltimore.
Wow.
And it's just, they're saying they're calling for some sort of purge or something, kind of like that dumb movie. And it's just ridiculous.
What does that mean, like a curfew?
No, you remember that movie, The Purge, where you had to, like, you went out and broke all the laws. It was basically lawlessness by government creed.
Okay.
Who is calling for this? Yeah, the protesters?
Like somebody on Facebook. They were apparently, that's just what I heard, they were calling for, like, a purge-like thing.
Well.
And I don't get why that's the point. When you're trying to bring light to this guy that they killed, now you're in the spotlight, taking it away from this guy, and now you're the bad guy.
Do you feel safe there? Are you afraid? Do you feel in fear for your safety?
I'm more afraid because I live out in the county, so I just drive in there. But I'm more afraid of people thinking it's okay because now all the cops, the National Guard, are focusing in Baltimore, that they're going to be more likely to do stuff outside of the city as well.
And that's where you live, is outside, just outside of Baltimore?
Right.
Well, I wish you good luck, Brett. Is there anything else you want to share about your experience so far?
A lot of people being skittish, scared, and you just, I don't know, just the police report's coming out Friday, so something's probably going to pop off then, too.
What's the weapons, just before you go, what's the weapons policy as far as, like, carrying a gun? Is it legal in Baltimore?
Oh, only if you're a cop, basically.
Really?
Yep, it's, to get a concealed or carrying it, it's almost, you have to be a police officer.
Wow.
And that's what I was saying. Like, why don't these store owners, you know, why don't they make these looters eat lead?
They can't.
Because they can't.
Thanks for the call, Brett. I appreciate hearing from you tonight. Yeah. And that comes back to around to something that I pointed out last night. You look at a situation like this, you look at Hurricane Katrina. Katrina's a perfect example where the average folks were pushed out of the city by police. They were told they had to leave. And because the average people tend to be law-abiding folks mostly, they left. And so they left their city to the ravages of both the police and the other criminals who were still there. And the police couldn't protect them, nor did the police care about protecting them. So there was all kinds of looting and destruction that went on because average folks were gone. And it's the average people with weapons who are the ones who are really keeping people safe. And so if people in Baltimore aren't able to carry weapons legally or carry a gun legally, then it's no surprise that looters are able to run wild and destroy anything they damn well feel like, because there's no one standing in their way.
Where are the Oath Keepers? Didn't they show up at one of these things in Ferguson?
They did show up in Ferguson, but it
was
later
on.
Come on,
Oath Keepers.
Yeah, maybe they will show up in Baltimore.
It's
Who
time.
Knows?
They're calling in the National Guard.
I got bad news for you, Derek J., though. You asked, is there a curfew? And the caller didn't know, but there's going to be a curfew starting tomorrow, according to this article over...
Okay, boys and girls, we're going to put you in bed now. It's
10 p.m.
8 p.m. Oh, 8, oh 10, 10 p.m.
5.
How generous of the city government to allow you to be out until 10.
So the story here at FoxNews.com, Maryland's governor called up the National Guard late today, hours after rioting gangs attacked police, injuring 15, set a patrol car on fire, and looted stores in a downtown section of Baltimore. Governor Larry Hogan issued a statement late Monday saying he was declaring a state of emergency and calling up the National Guard, saying, quote, "These acts of violence and destruction of property cannot and will not be tolerated," he said at a late night press conference. Baltimore's mayor, Stephanie Rawlings Blake, announced a 10 p.m. to 5 a.m. curfew, which would be imposed beginning on Tuesday. She also said emergency officials were constantly thwarted as they tried to restore calm and that firefighters trying to put out a blaze at a CVS store were hindered by someone who sliced holes in a hose connected to a fire hydrant.
What?
It's crazy.
Wow.
I've never heard
of
that before.
Yeah, that's going to vindicate a man's death. Yeah, just poke holes in a fire hose. That really follows.
It's just wanton destruction with no thought whatsoever.
Bunch of idiots.
It's ridiculous. It's sick. And this isn't getting justice for anyone. It's not going to encourage the process of getting justice. Baltimore schools closed for tomorrow. City police say they have reports of several people inside Mondawmin Mall looting and destroying property. A police spokesman said Monday night, that's tonight, that 15 officers had been injured in the violence and that two remained hospitalized while others had been treated and released. There have been 27 arrests. The Baltimore Orioles have postponed their home game tonight.
Oh, no.
Saying the decision followed a consultation with police. CVS Health, which had one store looted and set ablaze, announced it was closing some of its stores in Baltimore. The rioting, looting, and threats of further violence followed the funeral of Freddie Gray, who died on April 18th. I read it was 19th yesterday. But anyway, who's counting? A week after being injured while in police custody, Gray was being transported in a police vehicle when he suffered the injuries that ultimately proved fatal.
How could anybody sensible live in Baltimore after hearing this? Really? I mean, if you've got any sense at all, knowing that this sort of thing is going on and you're completely helpless against it. I mean, you're not even allowed to defend yourself.
And the police aren't protecting you.
And now mommy and daddy government is giving you a curfew. I think there are better places to live.
Absolutely. Let's see. So on Monday, police said an online call was issued for a purge at 3 p.m. Eastern, starting at Mondawmin Mall and ending in the downtown area. The type of threat is based on a movie called The Purge, whose plot involves rampant lawlessness.
This is in the article?
Yeah. It's right there. Tweets from the Baltimore Police Department and news footage showed roving gangs followed through on the online threat. One Twitter dispatch said, quote, a group of juveniles in the area of the mall were blocking traffic and there were reports of rock throwing. A police captain said at a press conference that seven police officers had been injured, one rendered unconscious, and several suffering broken bones. Looters were dragging merchandise out of several businesses near the mall. We can continue here in moments.
This isn't the Middle East. You can't throw rocks.
855 450 free. There's more coming up. It's Free Talk Live.
In a trial by jury, the primary function of a juror is not to dispense punishment to the accused. It is to protect your fellow citizens from being unjustly deprived of their life, liberty, or property. As a juror, you can say no to unjust laws and prevent government abuses of power by refusing to convict. Legislative, executive, judicial. The fourth branch of government is we the people. Find out more from the Fully Informed Jury Association at fija.org.
You've been lied to. Being overweight is not about overeating, not exercising, or a lack of self-control. Diets, gyms, and pills can't fix it. It's your hormones. Go to 99skinny.com for a free video where Dr. Steven Siskin explains the four hormonal barriers to weight loss in men and women over 40.
When I first started losing the weight, all my clothes were falling off. I got some skinny jeans, and my husband is chasing me around the table again. I couldn't be happier.
Go to 99skinny.com to see this riveting free video. That's 99skinny.com.
We live in a complicated society. Stressful issues are always popping up. Have you ever been treated unfairly by someone? Have you ever been overcharged for a repair? Have you ever signed a contract or a document? Worried about identity theft? How many times have you been in those unique situations where you just wanted to call an attorney to find out if you're right or wrong, or what your legal rights are? But every time you think about calling an attorney, what do you think about first? That's right. Who do you call, and how much will it cost? Our friends at Legal Shield have found a solution. With a nationwide network of 6,900 attorneys who average over 19 years of experience, Legal Shield's law firms take over 40,000 calls per week helping their members. For less than $20 per month, you can have access to Legal Shield on everything from the trivial to the traumatic. Let Legal Shield stand up for your rights at lsprotection.com. That's lsprotection.com. Or call 855-340-SAVE, 855-340-7283.
Results will vary from case to case.
The Shire Free Church offers a sanctuary to those seeking an escape from state churches.
The Shire Free Church is an interfaith, diverse group of people that may not share identical theological beliefs. As a member in or minister of the Shire Free Church, you are a sovereign individual and may be the faith of your choice.
We don't claim to have all of the answers.
We are open to all peaceful people.
We want to learn from each other.
What unifies the Shire Free Church and its diverse members is peace,
love,
and liberty. There are many paths to God, one for every individual.
The Shire Free Church does not define a specific path beyond those parameters that must be your foundation.
Peace as your way.
Love as your guide.
And liberty as your light.
Learn more at church.shiresociety.com.
That's church.shiresociety.com. If you want to know the latest about Free Talk Live before we go on the air, all you need to decide is how you want it delivered. It's your choice. Visit news.freetalklive.com. You can get emailed announcements and participate in contests via our email updates list. Plus, we have a Twitter account that you can follow and a Facebook page where you can become a fan. So visit news.freetalklive.com to get news about Free Talk Live as soon as it's announced and the way you want it delivered at news.freetalklive.com. That's news.freetalklive.com.
Are you a political activist who does things that the government might not like? Then this free ebook may save your life. Rats is your guide to protecting yourself against snitches, informers, informants, agents provocateur, narcs, finks, and similar vermin. Rats was written by OG libertarian Claire Wolfe. Rats is a short book, easy to read, and available free in many formats. Download Rats free at rats-nosnitch.com. That's rats-nosnitch.com.
While our satellite channel is free to listen to, it's not free for us. You can help us cover our satellite costs with the chip-in on the right side of the page at lrn.fm.
Free Talk Live. You may join us right here on the radio waves, toll-free at 855-450-FREE. That's 855-450-3733. And one of the things you can do to help Free Talk Live out is to support the African Satellite Fundraiser to help Free Talk Live get on and Flaming Freedom and dozens of other great liberty-oriented shows to get on satellite over Africa on what's called free-to-air satellite, which means that it's free to receive, meaning that the people who are listening to and watching free-to-air radio and television channels, they don't have to pay per month. So they just buy the one time, they buy the equipment, and then once that equipment is set up, there's no monthly charge for receiving free-to-air, which is why it's so popular in a place like Africa where people don't have a whole lot of money. You know, nobody, very few people in Africa could afford to pay a monthly satellite bill. And so I want to get Free Talk Live and LRN.FM and all the other great shows back on in Africa. Because we used to be on there. We were on gratis from our satellite company. I pay for a satellite channel over North America and Central America. And that same satellite company gave us what was supposed to be a two-month trial over Africa. It ended up being 2.5 years before they took us off the air. And so I really enjoyed being on in Africa, and I'd like to get back on. But we need your help. So please go to africa.lrn.fm, take a look at the details as to why this is so important. There's a little four-minute video there that you can watch, and there's perks, you know, little bonuses that you get if you contribute. You can contribute as low as $1, $5, $10, or go up to $1,000, $10,000. If you've got some money burning a hole in your pocket or your bank account, and you want to help us spread the message of liberty to a bunch of places where they could really use the message of liberty, please go to africa.lrn.fm. We're talking about Baltimore. We'll talk about the Supreme Court another night. This is breaking news. The Baltimore situation is continuing to boil over into violence. It's been going on now for days. It was particularly bad Saturday night. Today, there was the funeral for Freddie Gray, who was the victim, apparently, of Baltimore police officers. They took him into custody for no reason whatsoever. He looked at them and ran the other direction. There was no warrant for him. Just he ran, so they arrested him, probably charged him with resisting arrest, even though there was no real reason to arrest him. And then they put him into a van, and when he came out of that van at the jail or wherever it was he was being processed, he had sustained some kind of an injury, some sort of deadly spinal injury, which presumably happened while he was in that police van, which begs the question of, well, what happened to him? because the officers were claiming they didn't do anything. According to a story over at the Free Thought Project, it may have been what is called a nickel ride in the van. And we'll explain to you what that means here in a moment. But Wade is with us first, listening in Mississippi. Wade, you're on Free Talk Live with Ian and Derek J.
Yes. So I was just going to comment on the purge concept and the idea that some people are talking about. They're going to have a quote purge in Baltimore. I would like to give one thing straight, and that is that the Purge movie is based on the idea that state and local governments would surrender their authority so that the people could go wild for one night and just this rampant, you know, crime spree. And then, of course, the idea that, you know, that without the state and local government, that for some reason people are just going to go wild and go on some crazy crime spree. But anyway,
it's ridiculous.
So that's what I say. Totally ridiculous. So,
yeah.
And, you know, like I said, I stand out in the grocery store parking lot, and there's no state or local government officials anywhere around me. There's tons of people walking around, and nobody's going crazy. There's a purge right there.
Great point.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, people tend to behave themselves because it's in their best interest, because, you know, that's what society does. We get along because we want things to get better over time, and it's, you know, that's why we don't rob one another, beat one another, and kill one another generally.
I'm very suspicious of the people who make the argument that the only thing keeping humans from beating each other and stealing from each other is the existence of a state and local government. I am very suspicious of those people, because I wonder if they stand out in that parking lot and think to themselves, you know, I wish I could just, you know, take that person's car. I wish I could just drive someone else's car home, but I guess I'd get caught. You know, it's them. They are the ones who require
They're
government.
Projecting.
Yeah. And they think that everyone needs it to stay in line.
Yeah, there's a thousand scenarios like that that you can make up. I live out in a pretty rural area, you know, and, you know, I've never been attacked or robbed or anything, you know, and there I rarely see any state or local government official at all whatsoever.
Yeah, well, they're never there in time to protect you anyway. I mean, almost never.
Right.
They're cleaning up the mess and write a report and maybe do some investigative work, maybe, if you're important enough to them.
Right. Yeah,
Wade,
right.
Thanks for your call tonight. Good points, man.
All right, man.
Appreciate
Take
hearing
care.
From you. Baltimore, Maryland, over at thefreethoughtproject.com. And doesn't John Vibes live in Baltimore?
Yeah.
So John Vibes, one of the authors, I don't know if he wrote this one, but let's see here. Free Thought. Yeah, John Vibes. So great site, by the way. Thefreethoughtproject.com, reporting from on the ground. This week, protests and riots erupted in Baltimore in response to the police murder of an innocent 27-year-old man named Freddie Gray. According to police, Gray was first stopped and arrested on April 12th in the morning and was thrown into the back of a police van 15 minutes later. An hour later from that time, an ambulance was called to give him medical care, but he sadly fell into a coma and died soon after. I hadn't heard the coma part of the story. I guess that makes sense because I had...
Yeah, because he died days later, right?
Right. I had found myself wondering, why didn't he talk about what happened to him if he died days later? Well, he couldn't. An entire hour later, again, he was taken in. He suffered broken vertebra and an injured voice box, which required emergency spinal surgery, from which he never recovered. Many suspect that Gray was the victim of what's called a nickel ride, a horrific police torture tactic where a suspect is handcuffed and then placed in the back of a police van without restraints, then driven recklessly around town by police officers.
Which only they could do without getting pulled over, of course.
Of course. This practice has also been called a rough ride or a cowboy ride. Baltimore Police Commissioner Anthony Batts said Friday, quote, "We know he was not buckled in the transportation wagon as he should have been. No excuses for that, period. We know our police employees failed to get him medical attention in a timely manner multiple times." So that, to me, is a pretty good acknowledgement of what might have happened here. I mean, from the police spokesperson himself here, their commissioner, that he wasn't buckled up in that van. I know, I think it was Sam Dodson, and maybe I'm misremembering, but it was years ago, that one of the activists up here had a similar circumstance where they were placed in a police van with, again, there's never any restraints in these police vans. The only restraint you're in is in the handcuffs. Sometimes your legs are shackled, too. I don't think they had his legs shackled in this case. But usually, if you're in one of these police vans, there's no seat belts there. And if there was a seat belt, you wouldn't be able to get your hands on it because you're shackled.
Right.
So I know that it was – I'm almost certain it was Sam Dodson. Anyway, he was taken from the jail to some other, maybe a court location, and at some point, for no reason whatsoever, it wasn't like they almost got in an accident or something like that, but for no reason, the sheriff driving the van was driving in a very reckless manner and slammed on the brakes at one point, which resulted in the person who was being transported slamming themselves up against, you know, whatever barrier was back there.
I'm sure, and that was really funny for the driver.
The person felt like that was done on purpose, that was something that they did because they could, and there would be no consequences to them.
Yeah,
for it.
I've done this in small ways as a driver of my own car, just like jolting a little bit at a stop sign or maybe like hitting the brake to the beat of a song. Yeah, people do this, and I don't see it outside the realm of possibility that a sheriff would do this to hurt somebody.
All right, I take it back, Derek J. A second video has surfaced.
Yeah,
that has
where
shown
they take him out of the van, right? They've got him outside, and they're dragging him. His legs aren't even moving, right?
Apparently, they did place him in leg irons. So he was both shackled by hand and by foot when they put him back in that van.
Yeah.
And if you've got your feet shackled and your hands shackled,
there's nothing you can do.
You have no control whatsoever over what is happening to you in the back of that van. You are completely at the mercy of the person behind the driver's side of the van.
Yeah.
According,
it looks like they took him out too. I don't know if you've seen that video yet.
No, I have not.
Yeah, where he's outside, they're sort of just dragging him in. The person who took the video seems to have gotten to it too late. But there's a woman screaming like his legs are broken. They're just dragging him into the truck. And she's like, you're dragging him. His legs are broken. They're not even moving.
I saw that. I thought that was the first video. That wasn't the one you're talking about. That's the midpoint video.
No, I don't know. Now I'm confused.
Okay. There's a lot to learn here. Apparently,
thankfully, there's more than one video. That's good. There's enough video cameras around filming the police.
The police van stopped three times, according to NBC News, before arriving at the station. It stopped first so police could place leg irons on Gray, then a second time to deal with Mr. Gray, and the facts of that interaction are currently under investigation. Apparently, there was a third stop where they picked up a second prisoner. Now, whoever that guy was...
Maybe he could talk.
Yeah. What does he have to say about this situation? Presumably... We'll find out as time goes on here, and we'll let you know as soon as we know, and you can let us know if you know before we do. In the meantime, we'll see you online at freetalklive.com, and don't forget Derek's site, flamingfreedom.com.
Why did you move to the Shire?
I moved here to the Shire because there's other people around who take liberty just as seriously as I do.
I moved to the Shire because I saw videos of people challenging authority and thought that I could get support myself. It called to me, like, do this right now.
I wanted to be around people like me who got it, and once I got here, I knew there was nowhere else that I wanted to be.
I've always wanted to change the world, so I moved to the Shire to join people who were actually working towards doing the same thing.
The people here are awesome, loving, and positive. It was for the adventure and for the feeling of something important is happening here, and I just wanted to come to sort of be part of that.
Visit ShireSociety.com to read and sign the Shire Society Declaration and learn the reasons why, if you love liberty, you should immigrate to the Shire. Plus, add yourself to the Shire map at ShireSociety.com. That's ShireSociety.com. LRN.FM needs your help getting our satellite signal back on in Africa. Our satellite provider had us on at no charge from 2012 through February of this year when they pulled the channel off the air. Now we're trying to raise $22,000 to continue reaching people with the message of liberty in places where it's needed most. Please visit our Indiegogo fundraiser at africa.lrn.fm. Give what you can and share the link with your friends. africa.lrn.fm.
Here's a chance to do a little activism while you're cruising Facebook, Twitter, or Google+. Between the LOL cats, the recipes, the hot girls, and the inspirational sunrise memes, Free Talk Live's posts pass by your newsfeed. Like them. Comment. It gives us more exposure. If you don't see our posts, click like at facebook.freetalklive.com and then hover over it to click get notifications. It's an easy way to spread the ideas of liberty a bit further. I know you're busy, but you can spare that tenth of a calorie it takes to click on something. facebook.freetalklive.com.
The live edition of Liberty Conspiracy is next, after the news, here on the Liberty Radio Network, LRN.FM.
From Keene in the Shire, the Liberty Media capital of the world, this is Daryl W. Perry, host of FPP Radio News for Monday, April 27th, 2015. Silver is trading at $15.87 per ounce. Gold is valued at $1,187 per ounce. And according to BitcoinAverage.com, the average price of Bitcoin is $219. Antiwar.com reports for the Senate Republican majority to get enough votes for a series of anti-Iran amendments to an upcoming bill, which itself aims to block the Iran nuclear deal, they're going to need support from a number of Democrats. The strategy right now among Republican leaders is to try to coax the Democrats on board by adding a number of measures about Israel in the hopes that fear of angering the powerful Israeli lobby will oblige them to support the legislation. Dozens of amendments are expected, with many focusing on demand for Iran to publicly endorse Israel and for the administration to affirm that Iran is sufficiently pro-Israel to ease sanctions on them. There's an interesting split here, however, as AIPAC, one of the most powerful groups in this lobby, is openly opposing these efforts to make the bill more explicitly about Israel. It's unsurprising AIPAC should feel this way. After all, Israel and its lobbyists have been working tooth and nail to kill a diplomatic settlement with Iran, but that doesn't mean they want to have their names splattered all over the bill that does it. The hope among Senate hawks is that killing the deal is a prelude to a big war, and the last thing AIPAC needs is for Israel to be so directly responsible for that. For over 35 years, Robertson Roberts has been a trusted source for buying and selling your investment-grade precious metals. They also take Bitcoin for precious metal purchases and permanently removed the minimum purchase order for all orders paid in the digital currency. Call Robertson Roberts today for knowledgeable advice on investing and a forward-thinking approach to new technologies. 850-478-5270 or online at rrbi.co. UPI reports a Russian court jailed and fined a group of women who filmed themselves twerking in front of a World War II memorial on the country's Black Sea coast. Prosecutors sentenced Margarita Radetskaya to 15 days in jail for petty hooliganism, along with two other women who received 10-day sentences. Two additional women were fined, while the parents of a sixth dancer, who is under the age of 18, face fines and monitoring over charges of failing to perform parental duties for raising minors. The six can be seen in a YouTube video that was published on Friday performing a synchronized dance that at times utilizes twerking.